Good afternoon. The first item of business this afternoon is a debate on motion number 13160 in the name of Bruce Crawford on New Powers for Scotland, an interim report on the Smith Commission and the UK Government's proposals. Members who wish to speak in the debate should press the request to speak button now, and I call on Bruce Crawford to speak to and move the motion on behalf of the Devolution Further Powers Committee.
Presiding Officer, the Devolution Further Powers Committee was established in October last year. Its task to scrutinise proposals for further devolution arising out of the recommendations of the Smith Commission. It is our interim report published last week that we are here to debate today. This is the committee's initial view of the proposals thus far. Across the committee, we believe a report to be constructive, balanced and objective. We may differ across the committee on the powers we consider the Scottish Parliament should have, but what is clear is that we speak with a common voice in saying that, as a minimum, the spirit and substance of the Smith Commission recommendations must be delivered in full, in legislative terms and in the actions of both governments. Our conclusions was that in significant areas, the draft clauses published in January by the previous UK government unfortunately do not meet that objective. The committee has called on the new UK government to seriously consider the areas which we have highlighted which we believe the draft clauses fall short in. The UK government must ensure that the bill, expected to be published next week, is strengthened to fully deliver on the Smith recommendations. As a committee, we set ourselves four very clear and specific tasks in scrutinising proposals for further devolution. Firstly, to assess whether the draft legislative clauses published by the UK government implemented the Smith Commission recommendations. Secondly, to engage as widely as possible with stakeholders, communities and individuals. Thirdly, to obtain as wide a range of expert opinion as possible within the time frame available. And lastly, to publish a report which should seek to influence the content and development of a new Scotland bill. I'll let others judge whether we have met those objectives. I do however wish to thank all of those who provided evidence to the committee, whether in formal evidence sessions, at informal meetings, in local communities or at public meetings in Hamilton, Aberdeen or Shetland. In order to assist us in our task, we appointed three advisers. They were namely Christine O'Neill to provide advice on constitutional matters, Dr Heidi Poon dealing with taxation, and Professor Nicola McEwen with regard to welfare. Presiding Officer, I wish to put on record, and that of the committee, for the assistance of our advisers provided us in developing this report. I would also like to put on record our thanks to our clerking team, so ably led by Stephen Imrie. They did a fantastic job in preparing us in terms of the witnesses that were called and in helping to pull together our report. Most of all, however, I want to thank my fellow committee members for the mature, professional manner in which they approached their work. Our report has been agreed unanimously by all members of the committee. In my view, it carries far greater weight as a consequence of that. The recommendations we make are intended to be constructive and assist the UK government in producing legislation that will implement the Smith recommendations. It's important to note, though, in certain areas, such as the devolution of air passenger duty and aggregates levy, the draft clauses do indeed meet the aims of the Smith Commission, as far as the committee was concerned. But because of the time available, I have to focus on the broad areas where the committee found the draft clauses were not fit for purpose. In a wide range of areas, the committee considered that either clarification was required on the effect of a clause or that amendment was required to the clauses as currently drafted. Perhaps the most significant area we would consider that to be was on welfare. Specifically, the committee considered that the draft welfare clauses would not provide a Scottish Government with the power to, for instance, create new benefits in the areas of devolved responsibility or make discretionary payments in any area of welfare. The definitions of a carer and of disability would significantly constrain the policy autonomy of future Scottish Government in these areas. And the committee also considers that the clauses do not devolve all the powers over support for unemployed people expected by Smith. For example, the Access to Work programme would appear to remain reserved. We seek assurances that winter fuel payments will be devolved, and were there to be a future Scottish Government introduces a new benefit or top-up, that this will not result in any offsetting of reduction in a UK benefit. Now, the interaction of devolved and reserved powers is critical across many of the Smith Commission proposals. Universal credit provides an example of one such proposed shared power. In that light, the committee considered that the draft clauses at 20 in brackets 4 and 21 in brackets 3 could be considered or perceived to be a veto and need to be looked at again. More generally, we recommended that the principles which would inform intergovernmental working on welfare require to be placed in statute. That's a summary of our recommendations on welfare, and other members will no doubt want to go into more detail on these recommendations in due course. The draft welfare clauses are the area where perhaps most concerns rest, because they are potentially also the most complex to implement. And I know that's an area that's been carefully scrutinised by the Welfare Reform Committee. Presiding Officer, these clauses will impact upon some of the most vulnerable and disadvantaged individuals in Scottish society. And that reminded me of a quote that Sir Harry Burns is fond of recalling, of a Los Angeles priest who said to him, "What we need is compassion that stands in awe at the burdens the poor have to carry, rather than stands in judgment at the way they carry it." It's therefore essential that legislation in this area not only implements the spirit and substance of Smith, but is also capable of being implemented efficiently. The taxation powers proposed for devolution by Smith will also result in a significant degree of shared power between the Scottish and UK governments. Here, the most critical elements of the operation of powers is in the areas that weren't dealt with by draft clauses. Instead, the operation of these powers will be governed by a new fiscal framework, which is currently being developed. While the operation of the no detriment principle and block grant adjustment may sound esoteric, these issues are absolutely critical to the effective operation of these powers. In this area, the committee is grateful for the work that has been undertaken by the Finance Committee, who found clear differences between the Scottish and UK governments regarding the no detriment principle. Similarly, we recommend that greater clarity is required with regard to how no detriment will operate in practice. We have also made a number of detailed recommendations relating to the implementation of the taxation proposals, such as how to determine what constitutes Scottish VAT, but I will leave that for others to discuss. On borrowing, the draft clauses were silent on how a new borrowing regime will operate. Accordingly, any early understanding of what borrowing powers are being devolved should be a high priority for both governments at this point. In the committee's view, a move towards a prudential regime would provide a sensible approach. We also recommend that future Scottish Government should be able to retain any underspend in order to better manage volatility and income. Clearly, the current borrowing powers of the Scottish Government are too restrictive to cope with this new era of fiscal devolution. It is therefore imperative that the borrowing regime entered into provides genuine flexibility to future Scottish administrations. On the devolution of the Crown Estate, the committee also expressed significant concerns. The Smith Commission could not have been clearer in their recommendations on the Crown Estate. They said, "Responsibility for the management of the Crown Estate economic assets in Scotland and the revenue generated from those assets will be transferred to the Scottish Parliament." However, the committee found that the draft clauses in this area would result in the creation of two Crown Estates operating in Scotland. Let me assure you, Presiding Officer, that was a revelation was a considerable surprise to the committee, not least those members of the committee who also served on the Smith Commission. Moreover, the committee took the view that the legislative approach to devolution taken in draft clauses could be construed as being overly complex and complicated. Accordingly, the committee recommended that the UK Government should revise its approach to devolving the Crown Estate. I welcome the work now underway by the Rural Affairs Committee in this area. On the constitutional issues, the committee has made recommendations that seek to strengthen the draft clauses in relation to the permanency of the Scottish Parliament. In particular, that a referendum should be held of the Scottish people if there was ever a suggestion that this Parliament should be de-established. We have also made recommendations in relation to the Sewell Convention, and this is an issue, as we all know, has become much more relevant given the new UK Government's plans to repeal the Human Rights Act. The proposals for further devolution will, if implemented, result in a fundamental shift in the structure of devolution, Presiding Officer. Lord Smith recognised the importance of intergovernmental relations in the foreword to his Commission's report. Throughout the course of the committee's work, the importance of intergovernmental relations was a constant theme, raised as a critical issue underpinning the delivery of further devolution. As a committee, we agree with Lord Smith that the current largely non-statutory machinery of intergovernmental relations in the UK will not be sufficient to deal with the challenges arising from the proposals for further devolution. The committee recognises that for intergovernmental relations to operate effectively, there must be space for discussions between governments to take place in confidence. However, the general principles which will underpin intergovernmental relations and dispute resolution in future should, in the committee's view, be placed in statute. And central to any new structure or intergovernmental relations will be the role of this Parliament and, indeed, Westminster in scrutinising the actions of governments within this new structure. That will pose a significant new challenge to this Parliament. And this is an area that the committee intends to give further consideration to and thought about in the coming months. Presiding Officer, this report is the culmination of 7 months of intensive scrutiny, firstly of the Smith Commission recommendations and then of the draft legislative clauses produced by the previous UK Government. Now, I don't wish to sound conceited, it's not usually my style, on behalf of the committee, but the sense I have is that the report has been well received by a cross spectrum of Scottish society. And in this age of digital parliament, let me cite two tweets in my defence. Firstly, from a former member of the Smith Commission, Professor Adam Tompkins, who many will know well, some in this chamber certainly will know well. He said, "I'm quick to criticise the Scottish Parliament when it screws up, but today's report from the Devolution Committee is legislative scrutiny at its best." At the other end of the constitutional spectrum, Dr. Andrew Tickle of the Glasgow Caledonian University, perhaps better known to some as the author of the blog Lallan's Peat Warrior, considered the committee's report to be forensic, clear, constructive, and one of the best reports he'd seen come out of Holyrood. Now, don't make these points lightly. That's a message as much for this Parliament as it is for the Secretary of State for Scotland in terms of the contents of this report. It's now the ambition of all of the committee to see both the letter and spirit of the Smith Commission report fully translated into legislative package in the coming months. If the UK Government is getting ready to fire the starting pistol by introducing the Scotland Bill next week, then my committee is saying that we're not yet at the starting line, so let's not have a false start. Let's try to get the legislation right at the outset of the journey. Presiding Officer, it was in that spirit that Lewis MacDonald, Linda Fabiani, I met with David Mundell on Tuesday. We were pleased that he signalled an imminent introduction of the Scotland Bill and that he is planning to make some, and I stress some, changes to the Bill before introduction, most notably on the welfare clauses. All three of us welcomed the constructive dialogue we had with the Secretary of State for Scotland, but we also said we'd reserve judgment until we see the actual Bill, as there's still a lot of work ahead for the UK Government to get it right. We'd like to see as many changes as possible incorporated into the Bill before its introduction. But if that's not possible, then the Secretary of State for Scotland has a responsibility to clearly articulate what changes he intends to bring or make via government amendments during the passage of the Bill. Let's leave nothing to nuance or interpretation. We owe it to the people of Scotland to be crystal clear on what new powers are coming. That, I believe, Presiding Officer, is not just me speaking or other members of the SNP, but I believe all five political parties represented on the Devolution Further Powers Committee. And with that, I move the motion in my name. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Crawford. I now call on Don Swinney. Mr Swinney, around 10 minutes. Thank you.
Presiding Officer, I am grateful for the opportunity to set out for Parliament the Scottish Government's response to the Devolution Further Powers Committee interim report on further powers for the Scottish Parliament, which was published last Thursday. Like all members, I am extremely grateful to the committee for the work that they have done on this report. As Mr Crawford has said, this is a report which has demonstrated itself to be dispassionate, evidence-based and a considered report from the Devolution Further Powers Committee. It is particularly significant that it was a unanimous report and represents the views of all of those who participated in the committee process over which Mr Crawford presided. Mr Crawford was, as we would all expect, entirely measured in the way in which he expressed the committee's report and made it clear that his citing of the commendation that had been made of the contents of the report and its style to be simply for the benefit of Parliament and not in any way to reflect his own personal contribution. But let me just say at the outset that I don't think reports of the evidence-based, dispassionate and considered nature that we have seen from the Devolution Powers Committee come out by accident other than from the very careful stewardship of conveners like Mr Crawford, who has clearly presided over a process of evidence gathering within the committee and which has created such a strong basis for dispassionate conclusions to be arrived at. The report is part of a growing consensus around the forthcoming Scotland Bill. The Scottish Government has maintained since the publication of the draft clauses in January of the fact that there were a number of issues that were not properly addressed by the publication of the draft clauses in January, which had to be remedied. That view has been reflected in a number of contributions that have been made by various stakeholders in the course of the last few months. And now, a cross-party committee of Parliament has made the very serious and substantive and well-evidenced point that the draft clauses that were published by the United Kingdom Government in January did not implement in spirit and in substance the conclusions of the Smith Commission. And that essentially is the essential test and starting point for this debate, because what the people of Scotland have the right to expect at the very least is for the full and faithful implementation and translation into legislative reality without any doubts, without any uncertainties, without any interpretations required of the contents of the Smith Commission. And we now have a number of voices, whether it is the Scottish Government, and some people might say, well, they would say that, wouldn't they? But we also have stakeholders and we also have an all-party parliamentary committee saying that there is a necessity for the draft clauses to translate in spirit and in substance the Smith Commission into reality. And that is a fundamental part of the conclusions of the committee and of the debate this afternoon and in our consideration of the publication of the Scotland Bill when that emerges in the course of the next 7 days. Before I go on to set out a more detailed response on behalf of the Government to the report, I'd like to briefly recap on our route to this point. This Government has been clear that the result of the referendum last September was clear and decisive. While the Government still believes that independence is the best way forward for Scotland, we respect the result of the referendum and the view of the people of Scotland expressed democratically in that referendum. We therefore played a full and constructive part in the Smith process that followed the referendum to develop and to deliver more powers for this Parliament. The Government published detailed proposals for more powers for this Parliament in October as a contribution to Lord Smith's work founded on the acceptance of the fact that the additional powers we were setting out were powers that could be secured within the constitutional framework of the United Kingdom. Linda Fabiani and I represented the Scottish National Party on the Commission. Now, whilst we signed up to the conclusions of the Commission and we signed up to them in full and in good faith, it is no secret that we never viewed the proposals from that process as going nearly far enough, but we recognised the progress that had been made and sought to work constructively with the United Kingdom Government to enable them to deliver a Scotland Bill that commands broad support. The publication of the UK Government command paper in January was an important step in taking forward the proposals of the Smith Commission. However, it is clear to the Scottish Government at that time that the draft clauses did not deliver Smith in full, and we made that clear at the time. So the Scottish Government's priority since publication has been to work with the United Kingdom Government to improve the clauses and to ensure that the bill that is introduced delivers the spirit and the intent of the Smith Commission in full in a coherent and a practicable way. The Scottish Government, therefore, since the publication of the draft clauses, has made a number of detailed comments and observations to the United Kingdom Government about how the issues and deficiencies that we highlighted in January can be properly and fully taken into account by the UK Government in the formulation of the Scotland Bill. I would now like to turn to the details of the committee's exemplary report. This is an interim report by the committee and makes clear that it covers the areas of the bill of the highest importance. The committee quite rightly is waiting to see the bill as introduced and any changes during its progress through the UK parliamentary process before offering any recommendation on the question of whether the Scottish Parliament should give its legislative consent to the proposals. But even at this interim stage, it is highly significant that the conclusions that have been reached unanimously by the committee, providing cross-party endorsement of the view that the draft clauses do not meet the spirit or the substance of the Smith Commission report. A particular focus of the committee's report is the clauses on welfare and employment support. The committee found that the drafting of the clauses on new and top-up benefits would limit the policy discretion available to future Scottish governments, that the definitions of carers and disability were overly restrictive, and that there were unnecessary restrictions on the employment support programmes that could be delivered. Members will be aware that these are amongst the most high-profile areas where the Smith Commission reached agreement on the transfer of further powers to the Scottish Parliament. The significant shortfalls that the committee has identified will have a real impact on the Scottish Government's ability to deliver reform and improvement in these critical areas that is matched to the specific needs of the people of Scotland. The shortfalls in the relevant draft clauses therefore need to be addressed as a priority if the Scotland Bill is to be viewed as a credible reflection of the Smith proposals. The report also touches on the veto clauses in the draft bill, most notably the one related to changes to universal credit. The committee's recommendation here is for this issue to be resolved through joint working between the governments. I can tell the Chamber that the Scottish Government has made proposals to the United Kingdom Government to resolve this issue based on administrative tools such as concordats, effective joint working between officials and joint ministerial working groups. These are proven and well-established means of ensuring the sort of cooperation that will be required, and I continue to see no need for a statutory backstop. The committee also highlights shortfalls in other areas it has examined, from the Crown Estate to the Seoul Convention and Equalities.
Harry Scott.
Very grateful. He mentioned the Crown Estate. Of course, one of the committee's recommendations, building on Smith, is the implementation of the proposal to devolve the management of the Crown Estate's responsibilities to the islands. Does the government plan to take that matter forward?
Yes, the government does intend to take that forward, as has been the consistent position of the government throughout the process. But Mr Scott will appreciate, as a signatory to this report, that there are many issues and obstacles that have to be resolved about the contents of the provisions in the Scotland Act, the Scotland Bill on the Crown Estate, which are far from straightforward. The Scottish Government strongly supports the committee's call for improvements in the various areas that I have raised, and we've made our own proposals to the United Kingdom Government to deliver on those improvements. Before leaving the detail of the committee's report, I also want to touch on tax and the fiscal framework. Successful negotiation of the fiscal framework is one of my highest priorities in the months ahead. I have made clear to the United Kingdom Government that an acceptable fiscal framework is essential to allow the Scottish Government to recommend that this Parliament consents to the bill, and I don't suspect Parliament would expect anything else of the Government. I have asked for an early meeting with Treasury Ministers to review work so far, and the Chancellor and I made a personal agreement before the election to oversee work on the framework to ensure that rapid progress is made. In relation to the specific comments of the committee, I agree that further information will be required from both the UK and Scottish Governments to enable the Scottish Parliament to give its legislative consent. My objective is that the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament are clear about the financial implications, opportunities and risks that come with the powers that transfer through this bill. Presiding Officer, let me conclude my remarks by reflecting on the events since the general election 2 weeks ago today. The Prime Minister came to Scotland on Friday and met with the First Minister and with myself, along with the Secretary of State and the Parliamentary Under-Secretary of State. The discussions were constructive and helpful. There were clear commitments by the Prime Minister and the Secretary of State that the Scotland Bill would implement the Smith Commission in full, and of course we will test that commitment when we see the Scotland Bill on the 28th of May. Similarly, the Prime Minister undertook to consider proposals from the Scottish Government for devolution beyond the Smith Commission. We will put these proposals to the United Kingdom Government, and I will meet the Secretary of State to discuss the next steps in this respect. The Government is clear that the process that follows and any timetable for action in this respect should allow for full engagement with the people of Scotland. The Government is clear that the general election result in Scotland shows the desire of the people of Scotland for change. The Government will build on the Smith Commission proposals, which we will hold the UK Government to account for, to deliver in full, in, consistent with the arguments and explanations set out by the Devolution Further Powers Committee. And we will also propose a coherent set of powers that will allow this Parliament to encourage growth, create jobs, address poverty and tackle inequality in our country. These are the objectives of the Government as we take forward the constitutional agenda. Our priority is to ensure that the Scotland Bill reflects the, in full, in substance and in spirit, the contents of the Smith Commission report, and to put to the United Kingdom Government our proposals to extend and expand the powers of this Parliament to enable us to be able to tackle the issues that matter to the people of our country.
I now call Jackie Bailey. Ms Bailey, around about 6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Let me start by thanking the members and clerks of the Devolution Further Powers Committee for their work in bringing this report before the Chamber today. I am pleased that the Scottish Government's approach has been to take this unanimous report to use as the framework for discussion with the UK Government about the draft clauses that give effect to the Smith Agreement. And as the committee has said, all we want to see is that the letter and spirit of the Smith Agreement is fully translated into a legislative package which will be contained in the first Queen's speech of the new United Kingdom Parliament. Now, in the very short time available to me, I want to touch on three particular areas: public engagement, the fiscal framework and welfare. That said, there are a number of other technical and drafting issues that the committee explores fully in their report, and I commend the detail of that to the Chamber. One example of which is the need to tighten the wording of the clauses on equality provisions to ensure that the legislation allows for quotas to be set for the boardrooms of public bodies, which the majority in this chamber support. The lack of time to cover all of these issues in the chamber in debate today doesn't mean that they are any less important, and I am grateful to the committee for taking the time to scrutinise all of these for the Parliament. But let me turn to the first issue of public engagement. The Smith Commission was undoubtedly a swift process. The Commission members worked at a truly electrifying pace. But there is a need for more widespread understanding of what the powers are intended to be transferred. It is the case that if you asked, you know, any number of people, a substantial number indeed, are not aware of the powers that have actually been transferred to the Parliament in 2012, never mind what is proposed by Smith. So we should use this as an opportunity to have that dialogue, to talk about implementation, because, you know, having the power is one thing. Actually using it and how you use it is a much more interesting discussion. So let's take this opportunity both to inform, to discuss, and to listen as well. Secondly, there is the fiscal framework. There are substantial powers over taxation coming to this Parliament. Some indeed came to this Parliament for April 2016. Others flowing from the Smith Agreement could be by 2020 or indeed earlier. The report made clear that there was agreement with the draft legislative clauses, but that the key issue, which of course the Cabinet Secretary has highlighted, is one of implementation. Making sure that the Scottish Government and Her Majesty's Revenue and Customs talk to each other about the practicalities, defining residency, arrangements for collection, and so on, seems eminently sensible. And I concur with much of what the Cabinet Secretary said about making sure the fiscal framework is robust. Similarly, with VAT assignment and with the much quoted phrase of no detriment, there needs to be a much clearer understanding of what this in practice means. Now, one SNP MSP, who shall remain nameless because I think they said this to me in jest, defined no detriment as getting full fiscal autonomy for Scotland, but not worrying if the sums didn't add up, because you could always just shout, no detriment, and the UK government would bail us out. A bit like having one's cake and eating it. And I'm sure that isn't the SNP's position on this important matter. But in this and in other areas, intergovernmental relationships are critical. We do need a shared understanding, a shared evidence base to ensure that our legislation and approach is sound. Now, far be it for me to point out to the SNP and indeed the Tories that megaphone diplomacy of the kind that we've seen recently is unlikely to be conducive to that mature and sensible relationship in the interests of our country. But I do recognise that much of this is political theatre. But with all this new financial responsibility comes the need for much more robust and independent financial scrutiny. The Scottish Government is consulting on giving the Fiscal Commission legislative underpinning, and I very much welcome that. But it must do more than that. They should be truly independent from government. None of them should occupy a dual role as an advisor of government and to scrutinise in an independent function. They should have teeth to properly hold the Scottish Government to account for the nation's finances. There should be nothing for any of us to fear from that degree of transparency. Thirdly, let me turn to the area of welfare, because this is perhaps where the UK government has been most disappointing in their draft clauses. The Smith Agreement was clear. The Scottish Parliament should have the ability to create benefits in devolved areas, but it should also be able to top up reserved benefits if it so wished. These particular draft clauses illustrate, I believe, the behind-the-scenes efforts of the DWP to thwart the agreement, and it is simply not good enough. I believe in a UK-wide system of social security, guaranteeing a minimum safety net for every person across the United Kingdom. But I do strongly believe that it should be able, this Parliament should be able, to enhance those benefits to reflect different but specific needs in devolved nations. So in the welfare clauses, the UK Government does need to redraft so that the spirit and substance of the Smith Agreement is delivered. Already, though, the Government is illustrating that the debate goes further. The Labour Party, indeed, wanted the full devolution of housing benefit, something that wasn't supported by the majority within the Smith Commission. And the reason for wanting that is we want to abolish the bedroom tax, but also to look at how we better use the money to begin an ambitious programme of house building. But can I say, we need to spend as much time, if not more, on bedding down the powers we have and the powers that are coming, as we do debating the powers that we would also like to see. Devolution, though, can't simply be about transferring power from one parliament to another. That's not enough. From Westminster to Holyrood, from one set of politicians to another. We want to see power devolved further to local authorities, to communities themselves, empowered to do more. I have to confess, Presiding Officer, in closing, the SNP have, to me, been one of the most centralising governments. I think we need to reverse that. If we believe in devolving power, and I believe it's a principle shared across the chamber, then we need to move that power out of Edinburgh too.
Many thanks. I now call on Annabel Goldie. 6 minutes, please.
I too would like to take this opportunity to welcome the committee's report and to extend my thanks to the convener, Bruce Crawford, the committee members, the clerks and the committee advisers for what I think we all agree is a very thorough piece of work. This has been a significant exercise, and it is important that this Parliament is an effective forum to oversee how changes to the devolution settlement are implemented, and I think the committee has manifestly fulfilled its scrutiny obligation. I have to say, looking at the report, Mr. Crawford, I felt quite nostalgic and missing my presence on your committee. But, Deputy Presiding Officer, above all, it is important that our constitutional direction is a matter of building consensus rather than being politically divisive. And in that vein, I do pay tribute to the work of my fellow commissioners in the Smith Commission and, of course, Lord Smith of Kelvin himself, who, presented with a demanding schedule, as Jackie Bailey said, worked together to create a scheme of more powers that all parties represented in this chamber could agree upon. And now we are faced with the work of translating these statements of principle into legislation. It's now for us in the Scottish Parliament and for the UK Parliament to, in the words of the committee, provide constructive commentary on this process. We must ensure that the Smith Commission agreement is effectively brought forward, recognising both the spirit and the letter of the agreement itself, as both Bruce Crawford and the Cabinet Secretary have said. In that, I feel the committee has functioned very effectively. But, of course, this has two sides to it. And if I'm permitted the indulgence of the Chamber, I'm not surprisingly pleased that a Conservative majority was obtained a fortnight ago. We have a UK government in place that has implementing the Commission's proposals as an absolute priority, and these commitments will form an important part of the Queen's speech next week. But this is just the beginning of the process of bringing forward a new Effective Scotland Act that will make this chamber, this Parliament, one of the most powerful devolved legislators in the world. I'd rather make progress, if you don't mind. Time is tight. It is in the interests of both the UK and Scottish governments that the legislation reflects the Smith Agreement. And to that end, I'm sure the committee's views will be extremely useful, indeed cogent, in informing the work of the UK government as the bill progresses. But this is also a time, Deputy Presiding Officer, to reflect further on broader issues. And in that respect, it seems to me that the Scottish government reflects three positions in Scotland's constitutional future. The first, that the Smith Commission's recommendations be implemented, and implemented as a priority is something that we can all agree upon. The second, independence for Scotland and leaving the United Kingdom, is an argument that many in this chamber will reject, and it was roundly defeated in the referendum last year. But the third, of more powers beyond the Smith Commission recommendations, is more fluid. Now, some will feel that that option is still inadequate. Some will feel that that option is too much. But many, Deputy Presiding Officer, will at least want to explore what the Scottish Government has in mind. And both the Prime Minister and the new Secretary of State have met with the Scottish Government and have said they will listen to their views in this area. And I think that is a constructive approach. My question is when and in what format proposals in this area will be set out by the Scottish Government. Now, Deputy Presiding Officer, I'm not simply asking for a restatement of the SNP's proposals to the Smith Commission, because within that process and the call for evidence, we saw enormous opposition raised to some of the suggestions, such as the devolution of corporation tax, because in that regard, concerns were raised not just from business groups, but from bodies like the STUC, the Scotch Whisky Association, the Institute of Chartered Accountants in Scotland, and the Chartered Institute of Taxation. So, with little likelihood of building any sort of consensus around these sorts of proposals, I think it is important that if the Scottish Government intends to outline areas for further attention and devolution, they ought to be realistic and evidence-based. So, I think it would be a constructive contribution to any ongoing discussion for the Scottish Government to lay out what power, short of independence, it seeks, and also to indicate a framework for procurement of evidence and engagement with Civic Scotland. There are some signs of positive change, and it seems that the SNP, or at least some within the party, have recognised the instability of the full fiscal autonomy, which they once supported. I understand their new MP for East Lothian, for example, has said that, and I quote, fiscal autonomy without inbuilt UK-wide fiscal balancing would be tantamount to economic suicide. Deputy Presiding Officer, fiscal balancing, that pooling and sharing of resources that we spoke of during the referendum, is a vital component, not only of a common currency area, but of the economic union endorsed last year by the Scottish people. And of course, fiscal balancing must be supported by some level of common taxation. Now, the Smith Commission was careful not to pull apart the areas that support the UK's single domestic market, and I would like to see the Scottish Government recognise these principles, that the union people voted for is more than the absolute minimum theoretically required to maintain the UK as a state. So, in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, this is a process in which the views of this chamber matter a very great deal. By moving forward in a constructive way, we have the opportunity to create an enduring settlement based on that broad consensus. A powerhouse Scottish Parliament within the United Kingdom, with responsibility for what it raises as well as for what it spends, reflecting not just the wishes of many in this chamber, but reflecting the aspirations of the Scottish people. And this interim report, Deputy Presiding Officer, I think is a very positive first step in that process.
Thank you very much. We now turn to the open debate. Speeches of a maximum of 6 minutes, please. And I call Rob Gibson to be followed by Ian Gray.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. It's my pleasure to support the arguments in the paper today. and to point out that, in particular, I wish to comment on the work of the Crown Estate. Now, it's taken us decades to get to a stage where we can see issues related to the Crown Estate being devolved. We've seen the devolution of planning powers to local authorities, which took nearly a decade to achieve. And we saw demands in the Scotland Bill Committee before the 2012 Act for the Crown Estate to be devolved. It was not devolved at that time. So now we're in a position where we've got draft clauses which, in the legislative approach that's been adopted for the management and the revenues of the Crown Estate, they could be construed as overly complicated unless there's full transparency and full consultation with the Scottish Parliament and Government during the process. And looking at those draft clauses, it seems to us there are a range of things which have been touched on in brief by some of the previous speakers, and which I think I want to deal with in one or two greater details. For example, in the draft clause 23, where it says they may bring in a scheme to devolve, the word that we would like to see is the word shall. And we don't believe that parliamentary draftsmen would have any difficulty in understanding that and the import of it, because it looks as though something is being held back rather than generously offered. Now, the Smith Agreement was very clear that the management and revenue of the Crown Estate economic assets held in Scotland should be devolved. So, as was said earlier by Bruce Crawford, many of us were amazed that somehow or other there would be a continuation of the Crown Estate in another form. Indeed, two Crown Estates working in Scotland at the same time. Yes, we would see Crown assets devolved, but where, in fact, the Crown Estate in London decided that it wished to invest in Scotland, that it would continue to be able to do so under the scheme which is being proposed. So the committee was quite clear in saying that if there were to be a non-devolved Crown Estate, and we think this is a ridiculous concept, but if there were, then any of the profits that came from the investment in Scotland should accrue to this Parliament and for the Scots to decide how to spend them. Yes, Mr MacDonald.
And briefly.
I'm very grateful, and he is right that we highlighted concern around how that might work in practice, but what we were very clear not to do was to say that we would wish to prohibit any investment by any other public body within the United Kingdom in projects in Scotland.
Rob Gibson.
Well, thank you very much for that, but it still stands that we want to see our fair share of any profits which come from those, and that has been stated in our report quite categorically. Now, the Crown Estate deals with an entity called Fort Kinnaird, which is a shopping complex that's tied up in an English law that was created in 1907 as part of a partnership with a private entity that seems to be offshore. We're very unhappy about that continuation, and we also think that any profits from that should be shared from those assets in Scotland with the Scottish Parliament. Now, the coastline of Scotland is estimated to be around 10,250 miles. The Ordnance Survey has said that the coastline of Britain, that is GB, not Northern Ireland, is about 19,491 miles. Scotland has an inordinate importance of more than half of the coastline of Britain to make sure that we are able to apply the policies of this government to be able to decentralise control over Crown Estate assets and so on. And therefore, the Crown Estate is inordinately important to the Scots compared to what it is in the rest of Britain. And in that respect, we believe that at the earliest opportunity, we should have the chance to look at the Our Islands, Our Future initiative and make sure that that devolution continues. But that is not contained in the draft clauses at the present time, but it is a commitment from the SNP government, as I understand. The committee believes that there's scope for some communities for further devolution of the management of certain economic assets, such as harbours and port authorities and local marine interests and experts. So we've got to find ways to include these in further discussions, but that's beyond what Smith was talking about, and certainly far beyond what was being discussed with regards to the draft clauses. So we recommend that the Scottish Government keeps this and other committees in the Parliament up to date with the discussions with local authorities and others about their interests in taking on these powers. My own committee, the Rural Affairs, Climate Change and Environment Committee, has been bringing the Crown Estate Commissioner and his officers in Scotland into our Parliament each year to tell us about their activities, and that will allow us to interrogate their activities in greater detail. I would suggest to you, Presiding Officer, that the report provides a model of clarity about the things that require to be cleared up. A memorandum of understanding about issues related to UK interests in Scottish waters is another of these. But, Presiding Officer, fundamentally in conclusion, the issue about the staff in the Crown Estate is of considerable concern to us, because it becomes very obvious that they need to be accommodated in the approach of the Scottish Government to using the Crown Estate's powers, and that their expertise should be recognised and utilised, and some clarity given to them about their future. I'm glad to support this motion, and I hope that these clarifications help the debate. Thank you.
Thank you very much. And I call Ian Gray to be followed by Linda Fabiani.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. In the days since the election, in some sections it's become quite fashionable, I think, to denounce Smith. Of course, some started that quite early. My fellow member of the Smith Commission, Mr. Swinney, started his denunciation about 15 minutes after the report was released. But for my own erstwhile colleagues, some of them, it took a little longer before they jumped on that bandwagon. So I want to start by repaying tribute to the work of the Smith Commission and all the members of that commission, because the truth is the Smith Commission was given what many believe to be an absolutely impossible job, and in my view made a remarkably good fist of what they were asked to do. We were asked to deal with some extremely complex issues. We were asked to deal with it on a timescale which was very truncated, with this deadline of St Andrew's Day, so we had only around 10 weeks to do the work. The complexity of the issues that we were dealing with, I think, is one reason which comes through into the committee's report, that there were some things which the Commission did agree amongst ourselves we were not going to be able to resolve, and therefore they did have to be left for negotiation and discussion between the two governments, Scottish and UK government. And some reference has been made to some of those already. The fiscal arrangements, of course, the fiscal framework is one, and the detail of the borrowing regime. So I don't think we need to make any apology for the fact that those are elements of the relationship between the two administrations and parliaments which have to be worked out over time. There is not a devolved democratic structure, be it federal or otherwise, in the world, I think, which doesn't have some complexity within those fiscal frameworks and arrangements for fiscal transfer and borrowing. It was a process, too, in which a compromise was made, and you know, I was cheeky there with the Deputy First Minister about his reaction on the day the Smith Commission was published. But in all fairness to him and to Ms Fabiani, they made very clear from the start that they were not going to change their view that a devolved settlement wouldn't go far enough for them. But they were prepared, and indeed did, to take part in that process. And they compromised, and everyone on Smith, I think, did compromise. So we should, I think, take the chance to pay some tribute to that again. But, of course, the next difficult task was the draft legislation. And I know that drafting legislation is not easy. But, frankly, I simply have to agree with the Deputy First Minister that examination of the draft legislation does rather say that some of it does not, as he puts it, reflect both the spirit and the substance of what was agreed at Smith. And I want very quickly just to add my voice to some of the points which the committee have made, because I think the committee have done a remarkably clear-sighted job of what they were required to do by looking at the degree to which the draft legislation does reflect the agreement and where it does not. So in a number of areas, I just want to put in, as it were, my tuppence worth. On taxation, it was very clear in Smith that the agreement was that income tax was a shared tax, that a great deal of responsibility would be devolved, but that it would continue to be a shared tax. And that is why, for example, tax allowances were not devolved as part or recommended for devolution. And I just say gently that I think the use of the income tax devolution to try and justify what's called English votes for English laws has been one of the more reprehensible misuses of Smith since then. But I also want to say on a very particular point that that did also involve considerable debate as to whether it would be possible to set a zero rate in order to remove some taxpayers or make some taxpayers not liable for tax at all. And I just want to say that I am very, very clear that the Smith Agreement was that a zero rate should be possible, and so the legislation should reflect that. On welfare, I am absolutely clear that when we look at, for example, the £2.5 billion of welfare benefits which are to be devolved, what was intended was complete devolution of both those resources and the responsibility. In other words, if we look at one of them, carers' allowance, that would mean that a Scottish Government could simply take this money, get rid of carers' allowance altogether and use the money for something else. I don't think they would be likely to do that, but any idea that it means some control over a continuing carers' allowance is, from my point of view, simply incorrect. It is also the case that it was absolutely the intention that this Parliament ought to be able to create new benefits in devolved areas and not for a temporary period. And just in closing, I do want to say that on this side of the House, as Jackie Bailey has said, we're not close to the idea of going beyond Smith, and in particular in the area of housing benefit, we would like to continue to argue for that, because that is a case we think has great merit, and although we didn't win it in Smith, we will continue to make it. Not least because, and this is important, the arrangements in Smith were supposed to ensure that this Parliament would be able to abolish the bedroom tax, but they do so in a rather complicated and convoluted way. The simplest way to achieve that would be to devolve housing benefit, and that's just one reason why we will continue to argue for that as the process continues.
Many thanks. I now call Linda Fabiani to be followed by Tavish Scott.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Although things have very much moved on since last September, I think it's worth putting where we are today in context. It started pre-independence referendum with the vow that was made, and then with a post-referendum commitment of what Scotland could expect to happen next. That resulted in the committee being set up cross-party to look at devolution and further powers, and then with a very firm remit to study the draft clauses coming from Westminster, from the then government, in relation to the Smith Commission report, the Smith Agreement, upon which some in this chamber served on that Smith Commission. I think what's become very, very clear, and certainly has come out cross-party in the report that has been done by the committee, is that in fact the draft clauses that came from the Westminster government do not match either the spirit or the substance of the Smith report. And I think it's very, very telling and excellent that it is in fact cross-party agreement that this is not the case. By the nature of these events that I've outlined in the timescale, I would say there are issues to be further discussed to ensure that that Smith Agreement is delivered both in spirit and substance, and indeed that there is a coherence in the legislation which results from the Smith Commission. The Secretary of State for Scotland agreed with that point the other day when we met with him, I'm pleased to say. But I'd also like to be very clear about something else. We're talking here about intent. The spirit and substance of the Smith Agreement, which came from the intent of the Smith Commission, following on from commitments made. So it's about intent. It's not about interpretation. You cannot say that the Smith Agreement is there to be interpreted and that the draft clauses may in some way actually interpret it in one way, while perhaps I myself would interpret it in another. It's not that simple. To talk of interpretation is to belittle the commitments made. It's to belittle the cross-party work of my Smith Commission colleagues and the cross-party work of my colleagues in the Devolution and Further Powers Committee, not to mention the excellent contribution of advisers and witnesses. So I'd like to, I can't emphasise enough that the committee, cross-party, overall noted spirit and substance. And I would add to that clearly intent, not interpretation. There's a couple of things I'd like to particularly focus on, and I know my colleagues will focus on other things. The permanency of the Scottish Parliament, that was a big thing, both in the vow and post-referendum commitments. There was a lot of talk about this at the Smith Commission, and there was also a lot of talk about it at the committee. Certainly in the draft clause that has come up, provides that the Parliament and Government will be recognised as permanent. I don't see that there is any purpose, and I'm not sure what the expected effect is of adding these words. It's not at all clear, and I would think removing them would move the provision much closer to the Smith recommendation. And that's the view of the committee. And if we were to weaken the effect of that clause, it would be unfortunate, given that all-party agreement to the recommendation, and indeed the views expressed to us by the then Secretary of State for Scotland, that the permanence of the Scottish Parliament and Scottish Government is in fact guaranteed. So, we consider that the effect of the clause in permanency as currently drafted is declaratory and political rather than legal in effect. So we would recommend that, should there ever be any thought of a future UK government deciding that the Scottish Parliament was no longer required, this would have to be tested in a referendum of the people of Scotland, with majorities also being required in the Scottish Parliament and indeed in the UK Parliament. Because the Smith Agreement said clearly that nothing within any settlement precludes the sovereignty of the Scottish people. And this has been noted many times related to that. Devolution is a process, not an event. It was interesting when Lord Smith came up before the committee, he said, if you know a way of making the institution permanent, tell me, because that is the Scottish people's will. And I think we should bear that in mind at all times when we are talking about any legislation in respect of the powers to Scotland. I'm looking at the time. There's always a worry that you don't have enough to say, and then you start and you feel you could say so much more. I would also very much like to have talked at greater length about the Sewell Convention, because again, the committee was concerned that there was not enough emphasis being given to making sure that the UK Parliament could not, in fact, legislate against the will of the Scottish Parliament. I hope that the Secretary of State and his colleagues will look at that much more closely and redraft the clause before it is presented again to the UK Parliament. Very quickly, Presiding Officer, what underpins so much of all of this is intergovernmental relations and indeed inter-parliament relations as a subset of that. And I would hope that all concerned in trying to smooth the way for this, obtain additional powers for Scotland and coherence in that settlement, will bear in mind that it must be underpinned by respect on all sides. Thank you very much.
Many thanks. I now call Tavish Scott to be followed by Stuart McMillan.
Thank you very much, Deputy Presiding Officer. I should start too with the general adulation for the convener of the committee and all others who served on that. I must confess, I always take the Deputy First Minister very seriously in his remarks, but I do find it wonderful when the government say such nice things about a parliamentary committee report. I don't remember them saying such nice things about the minority report some of us produced on police centralisation, but I guess that's how these things go in in any parliament. There we are. There we are. I also, Mr. Crawford did handle it extremely well. I'm very pleased to join in that. But I may say I listened to the Today programme on the Friday morning with some chuckle as I heard the Deputy First Minister extolling the virtues both of the committee report and then, of course, the impending meeting between the Prime Minister and the First Minister. It only then dawned on me that, of course, the necessity to get the committee report out, which was the right thing to do, also beautifully coincided with the meeting between the First Minister, indeed the Deputy First Minister, the Prime Minister, and no doubt a great range of other very important people. And I'm sure our committee report helped enormously in those discussions. Next Friday, as the Deputy First Minister rightly said, the Queen's speech will then produce a draft Scotland bill. I suspect next Thursday, when the Queen's speech is read out, there may be more interest on the Tory benches about the in-out referendum on Europe rather than on the Scotland bill. But we can always hope that the Scotland bill will be top of the list, because it certainly should be, not just because of its implications for our nation, but also for its implications, I think, for the rest of this United Kingdom as well. Mr. Crawford, who is very careful with his language and is to be applauded for that, pointed out that the draft clauses do implement Smith in some areas but not in others, and I entirely agree with exactly that synopsis. The Deputy First Minister, who is also extremely careful with his language, didn't quite put it in those terms. And I do think it's important to recognise that what the committee has said is that the clauses do get it right in some areas but demonstrably don't in others, and don't, as Linda Fabiani has just said, just to happily give away this point, Linda Fabiani rightly said, don't implement the whole spirit of Smith with regard to some of the other areas which Mr. Swinney is no doubt about to tell me about.
I'm grateful to Mr. Scott.
Sorry, Deputy First Minister.
I'm very happy to associate myself with his remark that there are elements of the draft clauses which fully and entirely, and to the Scottish Government's satisfaction, implement the Smith Commission in spirit and in substance, but in some it doesn't.
I'm most grateful for that clarification, and I'm sure that's exactly as it should be. Mr. Swinney also mentioned in his remarks that he, of course, argues for independence. I would argue for something different. I believe if ever was a case now across this UK for a federal solution to the constitutional upheaval that we seem to perpetually go through and, more to the point, put our people through, then that is it. But Annabel Goldie made a good remark, a good observation in her opening, remarks, and that was around the parliamentary scrutiny of the points that the Deputy First Minister was making about the suggestions that his government have rightly made to strengthen the clauses that both the committee and many others consider to be deficient. That, in essence, is what the committee looked at. It's a very small part of the report, but it is a part that I think is important, and that is the parliamentary scrutiny of what government does. Now, I think I wrote down Mr. Crawford's observation that there needs to be, I think, as he said, space for confidential discussions, and he's right. Of course there should, and I, Jackie Bailey and Lewis MacDonald would all recognise exactly that requirement when governments talk. But similarly, there's a need to ensure that there is parliamentary scrutiny of that, and there are some examples from different parts of Europe, particularly Scandinavia, where they are, I think, in parliamentary terms, much more effective at looking at these kind of aspects. They're dull, they're dry, they're about politicians, looking at politicians and what they do, but actually they're about, of course, the policies that we implement. And similarly, one man's veto, of course, or one person's veto, rather, is another person's, you know, proper discussion. Today in the newspapers, in the Herald, for example, we have what the Herald describe as a new front in the First Minister's rapidly escalating fight with the UK government after she demanded a veto over Britain's energy policy. Well, we've been discussing, Mr. Crawford raised, and he rightly raised, the veto that some see in the context of the social security provisions in the bill. Well, here we have an example the other way around of a veto on another area of policy. So, all I can commend to the government, both the government of ours here in Scotland, but also the government down at Westminster, is an approach based on the recommendations that the committee have made about intergovernmental work and governmental activity. I heard the Deputy First Minister very interestingly say, if I caught him right, that he didn't believe there needed to be statutory backing for that. Now, I'm sure that's an area the committee may wish to come back to. I'm sure the Deputy First Minister, to his credit, will happily come along and explain his thinking on that. But I think there are those of us who might both have sympathy for his arguments, but also want to probe that completely to ensure that we get the right balance there so Parliament can do its appropriate job. Two final points, if I may, Deputy Presiding Officer. The first is to associate myself broadly with Rob Gibson's remarks about the Crown Estate. I mean, we can get a bit hung up about the two Crown Estates thing. We're going to get rid of one, and that, I think, I very strongly agree with his remarks on. And I also am grateful to the Deputy First Minister's answer to me earlier about devolution within Scotland, because I've believed that all my life, and I want to see that happen. And the final point I want to make is with regard to the fiscal framework, and I don't have time to go into the no detriment principle, but my contention in this area is that the government have got it right when they have made or seek to make the Fiscal Commission independent. I think that's fundamentally important for our deliberations of government activity, but the working relationship between the Office of Budget Responsibility on a UK-wide basis and the Fiscal Commission, once it is independent, is to me fundamentally important as to how we might resolve some of these outstanding issues. Thank you.
Many thanks. And I now call Stuart McMillan to be followed by Elaine Murray.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And the publication of this report and today's debate are further steps along Scotland's journey and the history that's actually been made, and I'm delighted, certainly, that members of the Inverclyde Historical Society are actually in the gallery today to actually witness today's contribution. Presiding Officer, I warmly welcome this debate, and I'm pleased that, as a committee, we can actually speak with one voice on the issues surrounding the draft clauses published on the 22nd of January. And I aim to focus my attention on two areas of the report. First of all, the fixed odds betting terminals, the FOBTs, that's paragraphs 412 to 415, and also the employment programmes, paragraphs 302 to 313. Regarding the FOBTs, members won't be surprised that I raise this issue once again in the Chamber, and I've been consistent in raising my concerns as to how damaging these machines actually are, and I've campaigned for more powers to actually come to this Parliament regarding these machines, and I welcomed their inclusion in the Smith recommendations, even though they are limited. Paragraph 415 of our report published last week clearly highlights our committee's limited evidence received on the issue, as well as highlighting our concerns on the limitations in the draft clauses, which would have no effect whatsoever on existing premises in Scotland. The area of FOBTs is now even more in need of further clarification, as the two new UK government ministers who will deal with gambling, as John Whittingdale MP, the new Culture, Media and Sports Secretary, has previously pushed for rules on FOBTs to be relaxed and has supported having up to 20 FOBT machines per betting shop. In contrast, the junior minister, Tracy Couch MP, who in 2013 said that she believed that we should look carefully at limiting them or limiting the stakes that people can actually place on them. These mixed messages at UK government level will need to be clarified as soon as possible, and that's why I've written to the UK government asking for that clarity. However, we as a committee will scrutinise these clauses in the bill when it's published next week. The second issue is that concerning the employment programmes. The Smith recommendations were crystal clear. Paragraph 57 of Smith said that the Scottish Parliament will have all powers over support for unemployed people through the employment programmes currently contracted by DWP on expiry of the current commercial arrangements. The draft clauses, unfortunately, don't go that far, and in paragraph 335 of our report from last week, we state that the committee considers that the clauses, as currently drafted, do not fully implement the Smith Commission recommendations. The committee considers that the Smith Commission intended that all employment programmes currently contracted by DWP should be devolved. We received evidence from organisations expressing their concern at the draft clauses on this issue. However, if we go back to the 4th of December 2014, when we took evidence from the then Scottish Secretary, Alistair Carmichael MP, on the issue of the work programme, then it's clear that there has been a lack of clarity about this particular issue from the outset. It was reported that day that the work programme had been extended to the spring of 2017, and when questioned by Linda Fabiani, MSP, Mr Carmichael stated that the decision had taken place in August 2014. However, when I questioned Mr Carmichael on whether Lord Smith was aware of this decision, he replied by stating that he didn't know, but my colleague Linda Fabiani, however, gave a determined no, and this is all on public record. I raise this point, Presiding Officer, not to be partisan, as most of the contributions so far, including mine up to now and what we'll say further, have been constructive and consensual, but to highlight one area where there actually has been a lack of clarity. Clearly, the draft clause 22 from the UK government published in January needs to be improved, and providing this Parliament with the ability to help all and to have the flexibility over the length of time an individual has been unemployed will aid greatly governments of all political hues in this Parliament going forward. Presiding Officer, the evidence we received on transferring employment powers was helpful. One such body to provide that evidence was the Employment Related Services Association, ERSA. They stated in paragraph 304, ERSA continues to believe that this, that's a sufficient provision, would be best achieved through the devolution of responsibility for all in-work and out-of-work welfare policies and benefits to the Scottish Government, including responsibility for Job Centre Plus in Scotland. Last week, the STUC signed a memorandum of understanding with the Scottish Government of further powers that should come to this Parliament as a priority. These included minimum wage, trade union employment law, health and safety law, equalities legislation and further powers over social security. If these powers can be transferred, they would provide this Parliament with greater flexibility and opportunity to help with the employment programmes such as the work programme or work choice, the latter programme being a specialist disability employment programme. Every member clearly wants more people into employment and training, and we should always strive to improve upon what actually is being done. Unfortunately, the current draft Clause 22, published in January, won't deliver what is needed, and the new UK Government have an opportunity to deliver something meaningful in the new bill from next week. In conclusion, Presiding Officer, in various areas of our report, we have highlighted that the draft clauses do not meet the spirit and substance of the Smith Commission recommendations. We also consider that our unanimous report should be taken into consideration by the new UK Government when it works on producing the new Scotland Bill. Clearly, the draft clauses don't go anywhere near far enough for the SNP members, and that obviously is a given. And we will continue to press on more powers to come to the Parliament. But nonetheless, I would suggest that the comments from Ben Thompson on the 23rd of January, and Ben Thompson is the chair of the Campaign for Scottish Home Rule, I think they're apt for the draft clauses. And he states, the real missed opportunity in this command paper is that it does not deliver a sustainable proposal based on a set of principles that give Scottish Parliament control over domestic policy. In other words, it does not deliver Scottish Home Rule. It's now up to the UK Government to strengthen these clauses and live up to the spirit and substance of Smith, and who knows, from my perspective, even go further than Smith. Thank you very much.
Many thanks. I now call Elaine Murray to be followed by Alison Johnston.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer, and I'm pleased to be able to speak in this debate despite not being a member of the committee. Committee members, clerks and witnesses are to be congratulated on a very detailed interim report which flags up a number of important issues which need to be addressed if the Smith Commission recommendations are to be properly implemented. As others have said, it is particularly commendable that the committee managed to reach consensus between five political parties on matters which are controversial, because that consensus makes this report all the more powerful, and I hope that the UK Government will therefore consider the issues raised with the utmost seriousness. The convener talked about intergovernmental relations, and Linda Fabiani at the end of her contribution indicated she would have liked to have said a bit more about the Seoul Convention. In fact, it was the committee's recommendations regarding the Seoul Convention and legislative consent memorandums which stood out to me as I looked through the report. The committee stated that the current draft clause 2 does not incorporate in legislation the process for consultation and consent where Westminster plans to legislate in a devolved area. The Law Society expressed concern to the committee that the draft clause does not place the Seoul Convention, whereby the Westminster Parliament does not normally legislate with regard to devolved matters without the consent of this Parliament, on a statutory footing. Professor Alan Page of the University of Dundee observed that, quote, it would be preferable for that to be made clear on the face of the legislation. I am concerned that the current situation should not be watered down. I want to see the need for consultation, and consultation with adequate time to do so, to be strengthened. Because despite the Law Society stating that the Seoul Convention had worked relatively well, our experience during my time on the Justice Committee is that it has not always been satisfactory. And if I could ask members to cast their mind back to the Legislative Consent Memorandum on the Antisocial Behaviour, Crime and Policing Act, which we passed on the 22nd of January last year. Although we did somewhat reluctantly agree to that legislation, the Justice Committee was sufficiently concerned about the proposals to criminalise forced marriage that we could not make a recommendation on that part of the LCM, and we asked the Parliamentary Bureau for a short debate. In that particular matter, members will recall that the Scottish Parliament had already passed our own legislation, the Forced Marriage, etc. Protection and Jurisdiction Scotland Act 2011, which was deemed thereafter to be in contravention to the Istanbul Convention. Scottish organisations representing women's ethnic minority groups hadn't had the opportunity that their sister organisations in England and Wales had to respond to the UK legislation. They were unable to put forward their view on how the Scottish Act was working, and in particular their arguments about why they felt it was not in contravention of the Convention, although indeed legal advice the committee received contradicted that view. There were also major changes in the maximum sentence for the criminal offence, which again were introduced in Scotland without consultation. I should again make it clear that it wasn't the policy intention that was a concern in this instance. It was the lack of consultation with Scottish stakeholders and the possible conflict with our own legislation. We were faced with the choice eventually between accepting an LCM which hadn't been subject to consultation in Scotland, or introducing emergency legislation here. And that's a path which we all know is strewn with pitfalls. And reluctantly, most of us accepted that the LCM was the better route. But committee members strongly felt, and I'm sure others could back me up on this, that the LCM process was flawed. The Justice Committee has also received other LCMs on Criminal Justice and Courts Act and the Serious Crime Act, for example. These were prompted by amendments introduced in the House of Lords. Now, though most of these hadn't been as sensitive as the forced marriage issue, there had been very little opportunity to receive evidence while adhering to the short timescales required for this Parliament to consent to the LCMs. So the Justice Committee, I think, has not found the LCM process to be ideal with regard to the opportunity for consultation prior to giving consent or otherwise. And I am therefore very concerned that this draft bill weakens the process rather than strengthening it. I'll give you an example. The UK Government's intention to scrap the Human Rights Act of 1998 further compound my belief that the LCM process has to be strengthened with regard to consultation and consent. This Scotland Act places obligations on this Parliament with regard to human rights. But if the Human Rights Act is repealed and a weaker British Bill of Rights is introduced at a UK level, we might receive LCMs which could contravene the legislation which founded this Parliament. It is clear that the vast majority of members of this Parliament are opposed to the repeal of the Human Rights Act, and if it is repealed by the UK Government and replaced by something weaker, it may be the decision of this Parliament to pass our own Human Rights Bill to protect human rights in those areas which are devolved. We may wish to do that. What happens then? UK legislation could be compliant with the provisions of the British Bill of Rights, but in contravention with the Scottish Human Rights Act. And this Parliament could be presented with LCMs which are incompatible with our own legislation. And I think human rights is one important example, but as responsibilities are devolved to this Parliament, there will be an increasing potential for divergence of legislation, and therefore complications if the UK Government seeks to legislate in devolved areas. So I think it is therefore essential that this clause is redrafted to reflect the need for consultation and consensus. And can I just conclude by saying that I very much agree with the convener that the UK Government really does need to get this bill right before it is introduced into Parliament at the UK level. I think that some of these are serious issues and concerns where we could be conflict between the Parliaments, conflict between this Parliament and the UK Parliament if we don't get these things right. And I think it's necessary for intergovernmental relations that we do so.
Many thanks. And I now call on Alison Johnston to be followed by Stuart Maxwell.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I too would like to recognise the diligence of the committee clerks in this process, our advisers, and thank all of those who gave evidence to assist in our deliberations. And the committee was, of course, chaired with flair, firmness and fairness by Bruce Crawford, and I'm only sorry I've been unable to make him blush.
Did you just come in for it? You've got flair.
Now, the committee was tasked with scrutinising the translation of the Smith Commission's recommendations into proposed law by the previous UK government. And as you've heard from committee colleagues, this scrutiny was undertaken in an atmosphere of mutual respect and with agreed determination that, and I quote from the report, both the letter and the spirit of the Smith Commission's report be fully translated into a legislative package. And a key conclusion can be reached by the committee can be found at paragraph 493 and states that in some of the areas, the committee believes that the current draft legislative proposals fully translate the political agreement reached in the Smith Commission but in other areas, improvements in drafting and further clarification are required. In some critical areas, the then UK government's draft legislative clauses fall short. In the time I have today, I'm going to outline where the Scottish Green Party is content that the clauses meet the letter and the spirit, and where we believe they do not. And I'm also going to stress, and Jackie Bailey touched on this too, the need to broaden public engagement as widely as possible as this process moves forward. Presiding Officer, I think it's fair to say that we're having this debate today because during the referendum, the people of Scotland, regardless of what side they were on in the debate, became so involved in the debate about what kind of Scotland they wanted to live in. Some 18,000 plus emails were received during the Smith Commission process. Now, given the tight timescale, I think it's fairly likely that they won't have all received the consideration they perhaps deserved. And we'll never have all the time we wish, but there is a little more time now for engagement. And I think that level of engagement illustrates, that is SCVO note, if it's to be meaningful and effective, devolution must be driven by the people of Scotland, and that there must be opportunities for the public to influence the process and contribute their views. The report states, as a key recommendation, that further public engagement directly with the people of Scotland, as well as representative bodies, charities, industry groups, voluntary bodies, is still a vital activity that needs to be carried out and is fully committed to the spirit of the recommendation made by the Smith Commission in this respect. The committee calls upon the UK and Scottish governments to consider how to commit to the spirit of the Smith Commission's recommendation in this respect. Now, the committee did what it could in this regard, got out and about and had meetings and engaged where possible, but I'd like this Parliament and that of the UK to consider properly how to broaden meaningful consultation. And I'd urge the government to look at things like citizens' juries, consensus conferences, and a method called charrettes has been used, as colleagues will know, in the planning system in Scotland, with some success. And these techniques are used across the world to help solve complex problems without top-down imposition by the so-called experts. And as colleagues have stressed today, one of the complex problem areas is welfare devolution. At FMQs last week, my colleague Patrick Harvey spoke of the tangible level of fear among so many people in the face of cuts to what remains of the welfare state. And the engender briefing for today sets out starkly how gendered the cuts have been. Since the coalition government started cutting, 85% of the money saved from tax and benefit changes has come from women's pockets. Yep. Well, we want to fix these wrongs that are harming women, children and vulnerable people. But there are genuine concerns that we won't get the devolution of welfare right. And our job hasn't been made easy by the complex devolution agreement, which potentially could make things even more confusing for people. The committee report has important recommendations to make sure we're able to create a system that works. And on top of that, women and those in receipt of benefits need to be much more involved in the design. Engender are calling for the administration of universal credit to be devolved early with a Section 30 order. And Jim McCormack also pointed out that we need much improved intergovernmental working if we're going to manage these really important areas of shared responsibility, like welfare, properly. Greens called for and welcomed agreement on the proposals for devolution of unconventional gas licensing, fuel poverty and energy efficiency programmes, and formal consultation on energy policy. And I agree with much of what the First Minister said yesterday on energy policy. Scotland needs a stronger voice. The Scottish Government has a moratorium on fracking, but there should be no delay on the public consultation. It's time for a complete ban, no delay on devolving the licensing regime. And the Crown Estate, as we've heard, is another area where the draft clauses don't deliver the Smith Agreement. For some reason, the proposed method of devolution is convoluted, described by land reform expert Andy Whiteman as opaque, complex and unnecessary. I strongly support the devolution of Crown Estate away from Holyrood, but there's no need for overly complex preconditions in an already complex settlement. The draft clauses do, in effect, allow two Crown Estates in Scotland, with one managed by commissioners in London and one managed by whatever sort of local devolution scheme is established. This is entirely at odds with the spirit of the Commission and must be rectified. Presiding Officer, I welcome colleagues' openness to the idea of building on Smith. There is too much to cover here, but I'll end on a final point that devolution must not stop at Holyrood. I wasn't campaigning for a mini Westminster in Edinburgh. And if the last couple of years have taught us anything at all, then surely they've taught us that we need to trust our local authorities, our communities and our people with more power. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call Stuart Maxwell to be followed by Mary Fee.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Presiding Officer, I think it's fair to say that in some senses we have been slightly overtaken by events. The general election changed things. We're at the start, not the end of a process, and that means that the watering down of some of the Smith proposals by the draft clauses means they do have to be revisited. Gordon Brown, of course, famously guaranteed that if Scotland voted no, then we're going to be within a year or two as close to a federal state as you can be in a country where one nation is 85% of the population. And if some think that the draft clauses deliver on that promise, then what about the promise made by the Prime Minister, David Cameron, on Monday the 18th of May in the House of Commons, when he said, "I hope and believe that we can bring the countries of our United Kingdom together, implementing the devolution agreed for Wales and Northern Ireland, creating in Scotland the strongest devolved government anywhere in the world." Let me repeat that promise made by the Prime Minister this week. We will create in Scotland the strongest devolved government anywhere in the world. Not only do the draft clauses not come anywhere near meeting that promise, but the Smith Commission proposals fall short of it as well. However, that is the test that the Prime Minister wishes us to judge his government's proposals by. The Devolution Committee asked Spice to provide an analysis of the amount of fiscal decentralisation in the UK compared to other OECD countries. The UK was almost at the very bottom of that graph. Belgium, Norway, Australia, Italy, Germany, Finland, Spain, the USA, Sweden, Switzerland, and Canada all scored much higher on both subnational government tax revenue as a percentage of total tax revenue and subnational government expenditure as a percentage of public expenditure. The amount of fiscal decentralisation to Scotland has been overplayed. Few financial powers have thus far been decentralised. The Smith proposals take us a little further, while the recommendations on devolving benefits does not take us very far forward at all. If the Prime Minister really means to make Scotland the strongest devolved government anywhere in the world, as he has promised, then his government's draft clauses are unrecognisable as the means to make this a reality. The Smith Commission did not recommend extensive powers for the Scottish Parliament on welfare, despite the pre-referendum promises, guarantees and vows. It listed some benefits to be devolved, but the vast bulk of welfare benefits were to remain reserved. However, the Smith report does state that the Scottish Parliament will have new powers to create new benefits in areas of devolved responsibility. Unfortunately, the draft clauses propose that the powers of the Scottish Parliament will apply as long as they specifically relate to areas of welfare responsibility that are devolved. Now, it doesn't sound necessarily a big difference, but this is a substantial difference and in no way meets either the spirit or the substance of the Smith recommendations. As Professor Spicker of Robert Gordon University mentioned in his submission to our committee, Schedule 5F of the Scotland Act 1998 implied a presumption that all benefits would be reserved unless explicit provision is made to the contrary. The draft clauses on further powers operate, and I'd like to quote Professor Spicker here, operate almost wholly by adding further exceptions. He also said that the clauses in the White Paper are not faithful to the recommendations of the Smith Commission. The key differences are the absence of the power to create new benefits and the restrictions placed on the categories of people to whom benefits refer. This restriction will have real consequences for the people of Scotland. It's not an abstract concept, particularly for our most vulnerable citizens. And unless the UK government makes substantial changes in this area, they will have failed in their promise to meet the Smith recommendations in full. One final point, Presiding Officer, on the power to create new or top-up benefits is a crucial one, that any additional income created by such new benefits introduced by the Scottish Parliament must provide additional income for recipients and not be offset by reductions in entitlements to benefits, tax credits or tax relief provided by the UK government. That is the unanimous view of the committee, and the UK government must rise to that challenge. Even the specific benefits that Smith proposed to be devolved have been restricted in the draft clauses. To give just two examples, it was recommended that benefits for carers be devolved, but the White Paper only proposes devolving benefits for unemployed carers. And while Smith recommended devolving industrial injuries disablement benefit, the White Paper proposes devolving industrial injuries disablement benefit, excluding prescribed industrial diseases. Now, I think this is important, and I'd like to quote from a research paper published by the Alliance for Cancer Prevention entitled Asbestos in Scotland as to why I think it is important. In the last quarter of the 20th century, the government's official statistics recorded rates of mesothelioma in Scotland running at 31% higher than the UK average, while in the Clydeside region, rates were almost double, and in Glasgow, the rates were 2.5 times higher than the UK average. A particular hotspot was the town of Clydebank, several miles west of Glasgow, which officially recorded the highest rate of mesothelioma mortality in the whole of the United Kingdom. Yet apparently, the Scottish Parliament cannot be trusted to deal with providing industrial injuries disablement benefit to the victims of asbestos. Given the failings of the draft clauses on welfare, I have to question and I have to ask Labour members this. If SNP MPs lodge amendments to the bill on devolving welfare powers, will Labour MPs support those amendments, or will they vote to keep welfare in the hands of majority Tory government? I think that's an important question. It's not, I think, an attempt to directly attack our colleagues on the Labour benches, but it's an extremely important question that the members of the public in this country need to know the answer to. Presiding officer, the general election reset the bar. The Scottish National Party received an overwhelming mandate from the people of Scotland. The Prime Minister has promised to make Scotland the strongest devolved parliament in the world. Therefore, the question for all of us here today is simple. Will we stand together and demand that the promise is honoured, or will some parties accept an offer that fails both in spirit and in substance to even meet the recommendations of the Smith Commission?
Thank you so much. I now call on Mary Fee to be followed by Christine Graham.
I welcome the opportunity to speak this afternoon, and in doing so, welcome the report by the Devolution and Further Powers Committee. And like previous members that have spoken today, can I thank Bruce Crawford and his committee for the work they have done to produce such a comprehensive report. Going forward, we need cross-party cooperation to make our additional powers work for all and to ensure that powers are used for a better Scotland. The Smith Agreement has set out a very clear path for Scotland to enhance and enshrine our Scottish Parliament. And amongst the wide-ranging proposals set out by Lord Smith, in particular, I welcome the proposal for votes at 16 and 17, the devolution of air passenger duty, tribunals, and most crucially, the devolution of welfare. With another 5 years of a Tory government, and a majority one at that, and their focus on reducing the welfare bill, our poorest and most vulnerable need the protection afforded to them through Smith. And I hope that we can all act upon these welfare issues as soon as practically possible, and indeed work together to see more powers on welfare coming to this Parliament. With the Scottish Parliament now within the final year of this session, I anticipate positively engaging with young people to ensure that their voices are heard and not ignored. And as a long-standing supporter of lowering the voting franchise, it was a joy to speak with 16 and 17-year-olds during the referendum campaign and hear their passion and interest, regardless of position taken. And the work of the Devolution Committee to engage with young people during informal events and online to seek their views is to be commended. As the Scottish Labour lead on infrastructure, capital investment and cities, I welcome and support the devolution of APD. The committee report shows overwhelming support for the devolution, in particular Glasgow, Edinburgh and Aberdeen Airport, who also try to ease concerns about cross-border effects in the result of the reduction of APD or indeed its abolishment. And in a past life, I sat on employment tribunals, and with my experience in mind, I wholeheartedly support the devolution of tribunals in order to improve access to justice. And as is stated in our Devolution Commission report, we believe that the operation of employment tribunals should be devolved, even when there is a continuing reservation of responsibility for common right across the UK. The administrative cost which has been forced upon workers wishing to seek justice from their employer goes against everything I believe in as a trade unionist. And with the further transfer of powers for tribunals, I hope this Parliament will unite in removing the punitive costs I have just referred to. The Smith Commission rightly discussed the issues surrounding victims of human trafficking, and I back the need for further exploration to extend the temporary right to remain in Scotland to victims of human trafficking, and I plead for both governments to work on the basis that victims must be protected from further abuse, in particular from their own home country, and if the temporary right to remain was withdrawn. On equality, there is a desire for gender quotas to be introduced to the boards of Scotland's public bodies. And again, I would encourage the Scottish Government to work with the UK Government to clear up what the committee regarded as doubt about the power of the Scottish Parliament to legislate for gender quotas. With further clarification needed, I eagerly look forward to the next steps of the Devolution Committee to hear more about the relationship between gender quotas and the Equality Act. I'm presiding officer on taxation. I join with others inside and outside this chamber in warning against a race to the bottom between the countries of this island. However, with the recommendation that the Scottish Parliament has the power to set the rates of income tax and the thresholds, we must use these powers to tackle inequality and injustice by redistributing wealth from top to bottom. And on borrowing, the committee reports that all the parties of the Smith Commission agree that current borrowing powers are restrictive and limited, and utilising the proposed borrowing powers will enable our infrastructure the investment they require. There is clearly further work required in regards to borrowing powers, and I wish the Devolution Committee every success in getting both governments to meet the challenges head on. I'm presiding officer, the Smith Commission reports that the Scottish Parliament will have the power to prevent the proliferation of payday loan shops, and this is another area I fully support action for. The Scottish Government can already tackle the problems of such payday loan shops through the planning process, but so far have not done so. Yet, as Citizens Advice Scotland highlights, the Scottish Parliament planning laws cannot tackle online access of payday companies. And in Renfrewshire, the Council has banned access to online payday loan companies in any of its public library computers. And this is a measure to be welcomed and supported by those wishing to tackle the debt problems caused by quick access to loans, but at a very heavy burden to the consumer. And with the UK Government expected to launch a bill for further powers next month, I look forward with great interest to see what comes from the bill and the subsequent inquiry from the Devolution Committee. And in closing, Presiding Officer, I hope that across the Chamber we can work together to strengthen our Parliament. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call on Christine Graham to be followed by Alec Rowley.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I commend the committee for this interim report. I was going to commend the convener, but I think he's had enough commendations. That's absolutely. I refer in particular to paragraph 5, which states, in short, all of the committee want to see both the letter and the spirit of the Smith Commission's report fully translated into a legislative package in the next UK Parliament. From what I'm hearing, from what I've read in the report, even that is not happening. But I want to go beyond that, and I want to focus on the pages on from 125 of the report headed Coherence and Cohesiveness of the Proposals for Further Devolution. It's a matter I raised in a previous debate on the 10th of December. I was a wee bit more fiery then, when it was the early days after the Smith Commission, when Smith's criteria was that proposals should be substantive and cohesive. And I argued that while we could state across this chamber, we've all got different views about what is substantive, and that's appropriate. But cohesive, we must see as something that we should be able to agree on. And when you look at the evidence, and there is a caveat to this, because I noted under that heading, it says the committee does not at this stage intend to take a collective position on this strand of evidence it has gathered, which is about the coherence and cohesiveness of the proposals. But the evidence isn't the evidence of politicians. It's the evidence of the very civic society that Alison Johnson referred to. Professor Michael Keating, who suggested that the devolution of a broader range of taxes would have provided greater flexibility to the Scottish Government. He did not see what was being proposed as cohesive. Dave Moxham of the STUC also saw a greater range of taxation powers to be devolved, again, because including employment law tribunals referred to by Mary Fee, because what is being proposed is not cohesive. Again, Poverty Alliance, Peter Kelly, called for control of the national minimum wage and much more to deal with poverty issues, because again, his view on behalf of the Poverty Alliance is the proposals were not cohesive. There was a range of organisations with welfare issues who highlighted the linkages between employability and equalities and suggested that devolution of equalities legislation and employment law would have resulted in a more coherent package of proposals for devolution. So we have many, many strands of evidence. One-parent families took the same view. So when you look at what's being proposed, and of course we want certain benefits devolved, but will that work? And even though my direction of travel, and it better be soon, is to independence, even if yours is not, and you simply are looking for a form of devolution, Smith, Smith Plus, Smith Maximum Plus, or whatever, you have to give it that test. Will it work? If you want to stabilise the UK, would these proposals stabilise it? Will they work? Before you even deal with intergovernmental dealings, you can't even look at that if what you have in your powers in here are not cohesive and coherent. So I have concerns about this being put forward. Huge concerns if we're not even getting Smith. But even beyond that, that we've not resolved these issues. And as others have said, we have moved on. We have moved on in the last election to the Scottish people, not voting for independence, but voting for more than Smith. There's no doubt about that. And this will not deal with it. And this will not deal with cohesiveness and substantial results. I'll now move on to the public engagement, which I also raised in December, because that Smith Commission done at breakneck speed, and those 18,000 people that submitted various proposals to Smith, Smith had written his report within a month. Of course, he didn't read them all. They took the trouble to put stuff in. But at the end of the day, politicians sorted something out. It didn't involve the Scottish people, whatever their views were. So I'm rather pleased that what the committee has said at the end of its key conclusions and recommendations, and again echoing Alison Johnson's point, the committee believes that further public engagement directly with the people of Scotland, as well as with representatives of those bodies I quoted, charities, industry groups, voluntary bodies, is a vital activity that needs to be carried out and is fully committed. So what we must not do is rush. We must do something that is appropriate for the people of Scotland. Of course, we continue with the Smith proposals, but that's no longer good enough. It's not good enough in what it's delivering, and it's not good enough because it's turning its back on what the people of Scotland may want, who've not had a voice in where we're going, and it's time they had. Thank you.
Thank you very much. I now call on Alec Rowley to be followed by Mark MacDonald, a generous 5-6 minutes.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. If I can just pick up on that point that Christine Graham talked about, where it was the stability of the United Kingdom, and I would have to say that the greatest threat to the stability of the United Kingdom right now is the fact that we have a British Prime Minister in Downing Street who used the threat of Scottish nationalism and played the English nationalism card in Middle England, to the disgrace, I think, of British politics. And that is the greatest threat right now. It's certainly not the SNP or the Smith Commission. If I can also thank the committee, Bruce Crawford, his chairmanship and the committee, for the work that they have done in producing this very detailed report. I have been able to skim through the report, but it's clearly a very valuable report, and I will study it in greater detail as we move forward. If I could pick up on the point that the Deputy First Minister made when he introduced this today, and he talked about the importance of substance, the importance of the Smith Commission being implemented in spirit and substance. And since then, I think most people have repeated that and used the term. But I would like to say that I absolutely agree and I would hope that there has been a fairly united view coming forward today. I think that this Parliament is united in saying that the spirit and the substance of the Smith Commission has absolutely got to be implemented, and I certainly for one, and I would hope my party would stand alongside the Deputy First Minister in making that point and making that point clear to the UK Government. I would also pick up on the point that the SCVO talked in their introduction, where they said if it's to be meaningful and effective, devolution must be driven by the Scottish people. And I absolutely agree with that point, and this report makes that point, and I think that's really important that we need to take, not just take the people of Scotland with us, but actually what we need to ensure is that the people of Scotland lead this debate and lead it as we move forward. Ian Gray made the point earlier where he said that he was open to further devolution, and I would certainly go further and say that I believe devolution is a journey, and we're on that journey, and that journey will take us further and beyond what the Smith Commission has come up with. And I accept Ian Gray's point that there was a timetable laid out there. That timetable had to be met for, in my opinion, obvious reasons, but you know, I don't see that as the end of the process. I think we will go much further than the Smith Commission itself. And that point was made by Jackie Bailey, where she highlighted housing benefit, and housing benefit being an area that certainly my own party thinks should be included. And it's an area, and it brings me to the point about, yes, the spirit and the Smith Commission and the substance must be implemented in full. But there has to then be a discussion that also involves the Scottish people and how we actually use the powers that we've got. And the specifics that Jackie Bailey talked about, housing benefit, is one that I certainly think that I will be making the argument for in terms of further devolution, because it is a national scandal when you look at the absolute waste in terms of the amounts of public money that is spent on housing benefit, and yet we have a housing crisis in Scotland. And actually, housing benefit, if it was being put to use properly, then we would be building more council houses, more public sector houses for rent across Scotland. And you know, I think that's where we need to move on to. I would say to Stuart Maxwell, we must move beyond the politics of grievance. But equally, I would accept we need to move beyond the politics of fear. We've got to embrace the journey that we're on in terms of devolution. There was a point that was made by Unison Scotland this week where they said that Unison Scotland has always been a strong supporter of a strong Scottish Parliament. In the run-up to the independence referendum, we produced Fairer Scotland and devolution. Since then, we've had the Smith Commission report, which, although it doesn't go as far as we argued for in its submission, it is an important step forward. It's an important step in the right direction, and I think it's important that we recognise that point and start to look at how we will use those powers. They then go on to say that doesn't mean, of course, that we have a simplistic approach where more devolution is automatically assumed to be better. The argument for full fiscal autonomy, for example, are very weak. Now, the Scottish Government have put a stronger case and have a case for full fiscal autonomy. What I'm keen to do is move away from the politics of fear and actually have that discussion, because let's have that debate and let's get on the table so that the people of Scotland can have that debate and have an open dialogue, not on the politics of fear, but actually setting out what full fiscal autonomy would mean for Scotland. You know, I argued in the referendum for a no vote. I did so because I believed that it was in Scotland's best interest to remain part of the United Kingdom, pooling and sharing resources where practical and where necessary, but at the same time bringing far greater powers to this place where necessary, where it was in the interest of Scotland. So today, in welcoming this report and having this debate, my view would very much be that, yes, we need to ensure the spirit of Smith is implemented, the substance of Smith is implemented, nothing else would be acceptable to this Parliament, and we should unite on that. But let's now have the debate about what more powers we need, but more importantly, how are we going to use those powers to make Scotland a more prosperous place where everyone in Scotland can enjoy the rewards that are available for a successful economy.
Many thanks. And I now call on Mark MacDonald. Up to 7 minutes, Mr.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. And can I just say I found Alec Rowley's contribution, as I often find Alec Rowley's contributions, to be measured and very interesting. And I think there were a lot of ideas there, which it's not for me, Presiding Officer, to involve myself in the internal affairs of other political parties. But I would simply say to Mr. Rowley that I understand that there may be a vacuum into which such positive ideas may well find a home. Can I thank the committee clerks, my fellow committee members, including our overthanked convener this afternoon, who have steered us very much towards what I think is what has been recognised both inside and outside this chamber as a substantial piece of work. But beyond that, the range of witnesses who came before the committee, because if it wasn't for the high quality of evidence that we received as a committee, I don't think we would have been able to come to the substantial conclusions that we drew as a result. Other members have highlighted the public meetings that took place. I was only able to attend the public meeting in Aberdeen. And one of the things that surprised me at that public meeting, Presiding Officer, was that the lack of awareness amongst individuals, many of whom were extremely politically active, both in the referendum campaign but in politics in general, the lack of awareness around not just what was in the draft clauses that the UK government had brought forward, but what was actually recommended by the Smith Commission in the first place. And I think that ties into what my colleague Christine Graham was saying about the fact that the public were not part of the process and didn't see themselves as part of the process of the drawing up of the Smith Commission conclusions. Now, I know that the timetable was very much a victim of campaign rhetoric and that the timetable that had been laid out during the course of the referendum campaign had to be adhered to for political reasons, but I do think it does give us pause that even those who you would consider to be politically aware were struggling to comprehend exactly what was on the table. There are a number of points in this debate that I think merit a little bit more examination. One is around the issue of the fiscal framework, which I think is absolutely vital. It's a very dry and technical area of the debate, but it's also an extremely important one. As well as being a member of the Devolution Further Powers Committee, I also have the pleasure of being a member of the Finance Committee, not a sentence that normally flows from the mouth of a member of the Finance Committee. But one of the things we've been doing on the Finance Committee is examining the issue around the fiscal framework. And I think that there are a number of issues that have been highlighted during our evidence taking and which also came up during the evidence sessions at the Devolution Further Powers Committee, which need to be examined further. Those are around tax competition and tax gaming, and also the issue of no detriment. And I cannot emphasise enough the importance of getting a firm definition and understanding of no detriment and what it means, because we are seeing, different interpretations, not just at governmental level, but also at academic level. And I know that there is hopefully going to be some work done to explore no detriment a little further, both in terms of its definition, but also in terms of its practical effects. But on the issue of gaming, one of the interesting pieces of evidence that we took was from Professor David Heald of Aberdeen University. And Professor Heald highlighted the autumn statement and what he saw as the disruptive potential of what the UK government does when it sets its tax policies. He said, "This Parliament, the Scottish Parliament, spent a long time trying to reform stamp duty land tax and to produce a property tax that would be implementable by the beginning of April. But the UK government has basically disrupted that implementation by suddenly changing the tax in the rest of the UK." And that, what I've referred to in committee evidence as the rabbit out of the hat approach that often happens at UK budget setting, I think we need to look at how that fits within the powers that are being devolved to this Parliament. On the issue of where we go from here and where we perhaps need to go further. I think one of the issues, and it covers the taxation element, and one of the areas where we took evidence and one piece of written evidence from NUS Scotland, which I thought was very interesting, was around the issue of savings and dividends, because one of the concerns that they highlighted was that by only devolving non-savings taxes, Scottish Parliament is put in a precarious position for any future tax rises, and particularly the introduction of a higher rate of tax. As was seen in the year before the introduction of the 50p rate in 2010, and then the year following the reduction to 45p, those who it affected were able to shift extremely large sums of money between years and between income and dividends. And there's a concern, I think, that were the powers not to be in possession of this Parliament, that could cause some difficulty. I think that's something that will merit a watchful eye and further examination as we go forward. We've heard mention of the STUC proposals, and I have to say that in yesterday's economy debate, I intervened on Jackie Bailey about whether the Labour Party were now going to come with us and with the STUC around the powers around employment law and the minimum wage. And in response to me, Jackie Bailey said, "I thank the member for his intervention. We will have an opportunity tomorrow to debate the full devolution package. I will also be speaking then, and I look forward to engaging with him on the substance of that issue." And I waited, and I waited, and I didn't hear whether or not Jackie Bailey and the Labour Party were going to go where STUC are clearly pushing for us to go. I can understand the reluctance of the Labour Party in advance of the referendum to make those commitments, because they were obviously hedging their bets on a Labour government coming to power. But now that we have the situation where we have a majority Tory government at Westminster, and the likely impact, I'm looking to the presiding officer to see if I can take the, okay, and the likely impact that is going to have on trade unions, on employment law, on minimum wage, will Jackie Bailey now join with STUC and Scottish Government in supporting that devolution?
Allow Jackie Bailey to honour a commitment.
Presiding officer, had of course I had the 7 minutes that the member had instead of the 6 minutes, I would have been able to develop that point fully. But I am happy to consider any suggestions coming from that member.
Well, I'll give Jackie Bailey a suggestion, and the suggestion is that when I say, "Will you join with the STUC and the Scottish Government in demanding that these powers are devolved?" Jackie Bailey should answer, "Yes." So there is my constructive suggestion to the member for how we can proceed on this. Finally, presiding officer, if I may, when we look at what is coming forward, we obviously have the bill being published next week. It will be interesting to see whether the very constructive points the committee has raised are factored into that bill. If they are not, what I would like to hear in the closing speeches, particularly from the Conservative benches but also from the Labour benches, is a commitment that they will lobby with us for Westminster
now,
to agree to amendments which will deliver the spirit and the substance of Smith. It is the very least that the Scottish people expect and deserve.
Thanks very much. We now move to closing speeches, and I now call on Alex Johnston. 7 minutes.
Thank you very much, presiding officer. It's been an interesting debate. At times it has been focused very much on key issues. At times it has wandered to some extent. But I will deal with the issues in much the way that others have done. First of all, the actions of the convener in bringing forward this unanimous report. He shouldn't be praised too much. There are one or two people within this Parliament who are actually pretty damn good at what they do. Bruce Crawford is one of them, and he delivered once again. Much has been made of the fact that the support for this report was unanimous, but it should not surprise anyone that a Conservative member of this Parliament should have demonstrated commitment to the Smith process. The Smith Commission sat on a relatively short timescale and brought together key ideas at a critical time in Scottish history in the days immediately after the referendum. It did so in an atmosphere which may well turn out to have been unique, and I think it is only appropriate that we should maintain our commitment. There are those who are concerned about the timescale that has been applied. In fact, Christine Graham described it as going forward at breakneck speed. Yet, if you remember, the commitment that was given immediately after the referendum, that there would be a timetable on day one, appeared to have been broken when it took us to lunchtime on day two to put the timetable together. And many on the losing side in the referendum cried betrayal at that very moment. So don't be surprised if timescale remains important to the newly elected UK government. As far as the ability of the individual clauses to translate the desires of the Smith Commission into law and into practice is concerned, there are varying degrees of success with the clauses that have been published. In terms of taxation, I'm particularly happy with what has come forward, but the weakness is perhaps the lack of detail, and issues like the fiscal framework, the concept of no detriment, the practices that will be involved in borrowing, and how we deal with assessing what the Scottish component of VAT actually is, are things that we will have to address as time goes on. It is the case, of course, that that will have to be done through a much stronger governmental framework. And intergovernmental relations are going to be absolutely key to this. And that's why it's a consolation to me to see progress being made on the development of a strong working relationship between our First Minister here in Scotland and our newly reappointed Prime Minister in Westminster. But the process we're involved in is the process driven by the Smith Commission. And it is important that we find ways to ensure that the promises that were made through Smith are brought about. These processes will be easier in some areas than in others, and it is particularly in the area of welfare that my concerns drove me to support the broad view of this committee. And yet, I am content that having discussed the matter with someone who was involved in the drafting of these clauses, that the intent was to give effect to Smith. However, the clauses as they currently exist remain questionable in my view as to whether they achieve these objectives. For that reason, I think in that area in particular, redrafting is necessary. The issue of the veto, for example, which was brought up on day one after the publication of the clauses, is in my view something of a red herring, but the wording of the clauses as drafted give rise to that concern, and consequently we need to be sure that we know what they mean before we go forward. There are a number of other issues, the Crown Estate, for example, which has thrown up questions since the publication of the draft clauses, which we did not anticipate before their publication. And I believe the Crown Estate issue will only get more complicated before we get to a solution on it. There are other aspects of this debate which I think I have to mention, and that is that we have also had those who have gone off in different directions. There are those who have been more concerned about process than they have about the Smith Commission itself. There are those who are more concerned about how we might use the policies or the policy driver for using the new powers once we have them. I believe that's a step too far during this debate. We need to know what powers we will have before we talk about policy. Perhaps that's something for next year's election campaign. There have also been those who are too concerned about what we might add to this process. I believe it would be a mistake to drop the Smith process, the current process, and simply go off and now try to argue for additional powers in some or other area. It is perfectly appropriate for our two governments to discuss where we would wish to go next, but it would be a foolish error to drop the current process in the hope of something better. I think we have a tremendous opportunity to put together a package of powers which will be coherent and which will deliver for Scotland. We must also remember that we have a process to go through, both in this Parliament, but much more relevantly in the Westminster Parliament, to deliver these new powers. And by virtue of the election that we've just been through, the Scottish National Party itself has a very strong representation in the House of Commons and will have the opportunity to amend and adjust this bill as it goes through Parliament. We must also remember, however, that Parliament has a role. And as we go forward, while the two governments will, of necessity, have to become closer and to have a better working relationship, we must never forget that Parliament must have a role. Don't lock Parliament out. Make sure Parliament has that role and we can make this work for the benefit of Scotland in the longer term.
Thanks very much. And I now call on Lewis MacDonald. 7 minutes or thereby, please, Mr MacDonald.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. Devolution is a process, not an event. And delivering Scotland's devolved Parliament was one of the highest priorities of the incoming Labour government of 1997. That was delivered in record quick time. It is now 16 years since this Parliament first met on the Mound and elected Donald Dewar as First Minister. The Scotland Act of 1998, which Donald Dewar delivered, was rightly praised for its clarity and directness. Critically, it provided that what was not reserved was devolved. And that provision removed a whole range of potential difficulties before they could arise, a point to which I will return in a moment. It also ensured that further devolution was bound to follow. Anything government did not do before 1998 but came to do afterwards would be devolved unless a specific decision was made to reserve responsibility for it to the United Kingdom Parliament. And so the process of devolution did follow. Just as the original Act implied, it was soon enhanced by both legislative and executive devolution of further powers. And on top of that, we have had step changes in the scale and scope of devolution with the Calmont Commission and the Scotland Act of 2012, and now with the Smith Commission and the Scotland Bill we expect to see next week. Indeed, with the Smith Agreement on the Crown Estate, we have a high-level commitment to devolution from this Parliament to Ireland and other communities, a commitment which I was glad to hear the Deputy First Minister repeat today. And I would remind Rob Gibson on that subject that the Smith Agreement commitment to further devolution to a local level was of the management of all the relevant economic assets, including the seabed, the foreshore where appropriate, and mineral and fishing rights. We cannot now pick and choose which aspects of the Smith Agreement we want government to implement.
Rob Gibson.
I thank the member for taking an intervention. I think when we're talking about deciding how these things should be done, it's not a question of whether the people at the most local level should control them, but we have to have a structure in which they do so. And the obvious place to do that is in this Parliament. Do you agree, Lewis MacDonald?
Well, I think what's important here is that the committee has come together across parties to call for the implementation of the Smith Agreement, and that's not a call that any of us should back down from, no matter what practical challenges are in the way in making that happen. But as has been said, the scheme to devolve devolution within the United Kingdom has been endorsed by every party in this Parliament, including those which campaigned to leave the UK. And that is the significance of the Smith Agreement. No party here today can reject that agreement because every party has signed it and undertaken to deliver it. At the same time, parties can argue for powers beyond Smith. We have done that today and others have done so too. And likewise, we have signed off the committee report on a cross-party basis. But at the same time, we clearly do have different views of the relative importance of different parts of the Smith Agreement and of the areas where the draft clauses fall short or are unclear. There may be issues of interpretation. There will be questions of priorities. There are differences of philosophy as well. When a number of us, as Bruce Crawford said, met the Secretary of State for Scotland at Whitehall this week, he, the Secretary of State, emphasised the issue of interpretation. But there should be no dubiety about how to interpret the intention of a new devolved power to create top-up welfare benefits. Since the Smith Agreement does not envisage claimants facing a clawback from other income, neither should the next Scotland Bill. Nor should the commitment to devolving employment programmes currently contracted by the DWP be artificially limited in the way the draft clauses propose. And devolving the power to abolish the bedroom tax is the clear intention of the Smith Agreement without disadvantaging those who receive discretionary housing payments. We would, of course, go beyond Smith in those areas. We would wholly devolve housing benefit rather than see it absorbed within universal credit. And we would seek to ensure that housing support was used in a range of ways to benefit those in greatest need, not least in providing
more and better social housing. Scottish Labour's priorities will be to use the new fiscal resources and the new spending powers to protect those in the lowest incomes, as well as to support the creation of jobs and opportunities through devolved employment programmes. The Smith Agreement allows us to do much of that if it is delivered in full, and that is our priority at this stage. But if we go back to first principles, the legislation we see next week will inevitably lack some of the clarity and simplicity achieved by Donald Dewar's original Scotland Act. That Scotland Act grew out of a constitutional convention. That was not an all-party process, although it had the support of a number of parties here. But nonetheless, it grew out and developed and came as a statute from that Labour government with a very clear a basis on which the devolution settlement could devolve. Under that Act, broadly speaking, powers and areas of responsibility were either reserved or devolved. Now, as has been said in the debate already, responsibilities which were previously reserved are to be shared in future, whether in areas of taxation or in areas of public spending. That must inevitably mean a less clear division of powers in the future devolution settlement. That simply reflects the complexity of the Smith Agreement itself and the choices which have been made in that context. On welfare, for example, the simple model of reserving the whole area of legislative responsibility for social security is to be replaced by a new web of exceptions to reservations and exceptions to exceptions. And likewise, the devolution of the Crown Estate is to be done by way of a scheme to devolve its economic assets, rather than simply by removing the Crown Estate as a whole from the schedule of reserved powers. Now, some of the flaws identified in the report can be sorted by intergovernmental agreements or by relatively straightforward changes to the draft clauses. Others may require more far-reaching amendments. But whatever we do, I don't think we can credibly insist on implementation of the Smith Agreement and then claim that the lack of coherence of that settlement means it cannot stand. If all parties compromised in order to reach the Smith Agreement and all parties have taken a mature approach, as Bruce Crawford called it, to agree today's report, then all parties must get behind the new, more complex devolution scheme once it has been delivered and make it work. And whatever the outcome of the parliamentary process over the next few months, it will mean both parliaments in future working within a more complex devolution settlement than we have done for the last 16 years. And how governments work together will become all the more important, as well as the mechanisms for holding ministers to account by elected members of both parliaments. Bruce Crawford highlighted the committee's call for the general principles of intergovernment working to be placed in statute. I was somewhat surprised to hear John Swinney appear to reject that view, but that is no doubt an issue we will return to before too long, and indeed he may have something more to say. For now, we support this committee report as a yardstick by which to measure the bill which is produced next week and the basis for the next stage in the process of devolution.
Many thanks. I now call on John Swinney. Up to 9 minutes, please, Mr. Swinney.
President Officer, this has been a very wide-ranging and constructive debate this afternoon, but within this wide-ranging debate there was one very specific contribution on a particular issue which Dr. Murray raised. And as usual, the detailed and thoughtful way that Dr. Murray raises these points about the application of the Sewell Convention and its operation, in particular its application to the Human Rights Act. And I want to just take a couple of moments to address some of what Dr. Murray raised, because I suspect a great deal more of what she raised about the implications around the stance of the current United Kingdom government on human rights provision will require some very detailed legal analysis which Parliament will have to consider. But the points that Dr. Murray raised about just how confident we could be in the robustness of the Sewell Convention is directly applicable to what we might face on the Human Rights Act. Because there will undoubtedly, for the UK government, the current UK government to repeal the Human Rights Act and to replace it with a British Bill of Rights will require the agreement of this Parliament in a legislative consent motion consistent with the Sewell Convention. But some of what Dr. Murray then went on to raise about the possibility of this Parliament legislating in the sphere of human rights will be very complicated for us to consider, given the fact that the Human Rights Act is named in Schedule 4 and therefore an area which this Parliament is prohibited from amending. So I think the issues that Dr. Murray raised on a point of great detail illustrate the significance that can be attached to some of the provisions within the Smith provisions, and we certainly have to make sure that nothing happens that in any way diminishes the effective control that this Parliament has to protect the legitimate interests of the devolved settlement in relation to some of these questions. Now, I think the debate has benefited enormously from taking place in what I might call the cool aftermath of the general election, where I notice a significant reduction in the tone and tension within the parliamentary chamber. So much so that Ian Gray managed to find himself able to say that he agreed with the Deputy First Minister, which is a joyous... Us former commissioners must stick together, Mr Gray, in all of these respects. But I think... I don't say this to in any way cast aspersions, but I think when the United Kingdom government set out their clauses in January, some of the reaction within Parliament to the points put forward by the Scottish Government was almost to suggest that we were trying to pick a fight where no fight was to be picked. And here we find ourselves now today in Parliament with Mr Gray accepting that the spirit and the substance of the Smith Commission has not been implemented in the clauses. And I welcome that. And I welcome that where it's come from across the political spectrum, because it really makes an utterly compelling proposition to the United Kingdom Government that if they are to live up to their rhetoric, they have to accept that what was published in January is just not sufficient to satisfy the commitment to translate Smith in spirit and in substance into legislation. And some of that is evidenced by the contributions that a number of members have made. Rob Gibson's contribution in the terms around the Crown Estate, the draft legislation says that there may be provision rather than there shall be. And we all know what may means. That means might, perhaps. And we know what shall means. It will. It must. It will happen. Linda Fabiani talked about why was it necessary to put into the draft clauses the words about the permanency of this Parliament, that the Parliament would be recognised as Parliament, as permanent. Why don't we just say Parliament's permanent? And that really entrenches the position as well as it can be entrenched within the unwritten constitution of the United Kingdom. So I do think the Scottish Parliament, really with some force, has expressed its view that what was published on the 22nd of January, yes, on time, it was on time, I can't quibble about the timescale, it was on, it was even early. But like most of the capital projects of the Scottish Government, I might add. I should have prevented myself from encouraging Jackie Bailey to get to her feet.
Jackie Bailey.
I wonder whether he doesn't regret that last remark, given that there are discussions with ONS and Eurostat about the validity of some capital projects, whether they're on or off budget. And indeed, in my own local area, Our Lady in St Patrick's High School has been delayed as a result.
Well, there's Jackie Bailey always want to break a consensus when she can find one to break. So the point that we've got to in this debate is to recognise that the provisions of the clauses must be substantially improved to fulfil the commitments in Smith. And I want to make absolutely crystal clear the position of the Scottish Government, that delivery of the Smith Commission proposals is not and should not be seen as any response to the outcome of the general election. It should be seen as the fulfilment of the commitment made post-referendum, and it is the absolute minimum that must be delivered by the United Kingdom Government, because to do anything else would be a breach of faith to the people of this country, given the fact that, from our different points of view, we came together in the Smith Commission and argued for the propositions that we put forward. So the Scottish Government believes that the delivery of the spirit and the substance of the Smith Commission report is entirely related to the post-referendum outcome and nothing to do with the post-election outcome. Now, what's been interesting, the other interesting element of the debate has been the recognition that there is still space for further constitutional development. I've obviously set out the aspirations of the government to move into further for further powers to be devolved to the Parliament within the structure of the United Kingdom. Ian Gray made the argument for housing benefit, which he made in the Smith Commission and has repeated it today. Mr Rowley very clearly said that there were further responsibilities that should be transferred to this Parliament within the devolved settlement. So there is clearly a debate to be had about how we expand and extend the powers of the Scottish Parliament. And Alison Johnston was absolutely correct to say, and Annabel Goldie has made this point in question time to me just in the course of the last week, that it is essential that we have dialogue with members of the public in Scotland about how we most effectively do that. To ensure, and Christine Graham made this point about the 18,000 members of the public that had submitted to the Smith Commission, but whose voices I don't think any of us who participated in the Smith Commission could feel that we did justice to the input because of the timescale that was involved. So we are at a moment, particularly after the general election, and anybody looking at the general election outcome has to say and conclude that the people of Scotland were indicating that they had a desire for there to be greater responsibility vested in this Parliament. And that is an issue to which we must turn our minds, and we will discuss that with the Secretary of State, but I give my commitment to wider public participation in that respect. The final point I want to make is about intergovernmental arrangements, because a lot has been talked about how governments need to work together to arrive at conclusions. And I reaffirm the Scottish Government's desire to work constructively with the United Kingdom Government in any way that we can on our joint agendas. There will be issues upon which we disagree. The Human Rights Act is one of them, where we fundamentally disagree with the United Kingdom Government, and we'll say so. And there are other issues on which we are in disagreement. But I think I come back to my point about my reflection on the post-election tone of this debate. I hope members will understand that the Scottish Government sometimes has to dig its heels in to protect the interests of this Parliament and this country. If I hadn't dug my heels in about the block grant adjustment about land and buildings transaction tax, this Parliament would have ended up with a worse deal because of what was proposed by Her Majesty's Treasury. And that will be crucial in the fiscal framework. It will be crucial in the working arrangements. And we cannot proceed on the basis that the United Kingdom Government has the ability to impose upon the Scottish Government and the Scottish Parliament arrangements that suit them, but do not suit Scotland and do not suit the devolved interests of the Scottish Parliament. And that will be the position that the Scottish Government takes in taking forward the necessity of intergovernmental cooperation to implement these provisions.
Many thanks. I now call on Duncan McNeill to wind up the debate until 5 o'clock.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. In time-honoured fashion, I rise to say that this has been an interesting debate, just as others have said, and I think to express some gratitude, I think, on behalf of the committee about the tone of this debate and the complex issues that have been raised in which the committee have been debating and discussing. I think that statements that have been made today have been considered, and there have been valuable contributions across the chamber. That consensus that's been brought about with the sainted Bruce Crawford, our convener, has become almost a contagion. It's great to see that sometimes that doesn't lead to interesting afternoons in this chamber, but today I think it has, because it highlights a great degree of common objectives here that maybe we should focus on in the future and make some progress on. The Devolution and Further Powers Committee, of course, considered the detailed areas of the Smith Commissions, and recommendations clearly have yet not been fully implemented into draft legislation. The committee's report, as you have heard once or twice this afternoon, has been agreed unanimously by all members of the committee, and I believe is a stronger report because of that fact. And, Presiding Officer, it shows, I think, that the committee system is stronger than some people believe. And it's a good example of what can be achieved. Indeed, I think it's the first parliamentary report on this issue that I'm aware of, at least, that all parties were on the Smith Commission have signed up to. I echo the views of the convener and pay tribute to all members of the committee for their efforts in achieving that outcome. And I think the way they have approached it, and you've heard some contributions here today about some difficult areas, they've taken a particular interest in many of those areas, and they've reflected that in their discussion. And as a consequence of that considered report, focusing on the facts, letting the facts speak for themselves, focusing on the job in hand, I think that we have received wide acclaim for the report across Scotland, which Bruce Crawford, the convener, mentioned earlier. And as a consequence, for that reason, both the Scottish and UK government need to pay very careful attention to the committee's report and ensure that any future Scotland bill addresses the issues that we have raised. Our report is a considered and constructive contribution to the process and further devolution. Where the process will or should end was not the aim of the committee and inquiry and its scrutiny. And maybe that was that we were able to get consensus because that issue is still ongoing. And I'm sure that the committee and the discussion about further powers, which were mentioned by Annabel Goldie and indeed the Deputy First Minister, we have plans to get the Secretary, a new Secretary of State for Scotland, to come in before the committee and indeed the Deputy First Minister. And there will be opportunities to talk about that further devolution that may and may not be there. Our focus, Presiding Officers, was whether the previous UK government's draft legislation clauses had fully implemented the Smith Commission recommendations. Our conclusion was clear. In substantial areas, the draft clauses do not yet achieve that objective. Members have considered in detail the areas that we have identified where redrafting, clarification or proposals have still to be developed if the further powers that have been agreed to by all parties are to be delivered. I want to make it clear that I do not approach this debate in the spirit that the pursuit of new powers for this Parliament, as alluded to by Jackie Bailey and Alison Johnson, are an end in themselves. But I do recognise that the Smith recommendations have been agreed by all the parties represented in this chamber, and that the new UK government must deliver on both the spirit and the substance of the Smith Commission recommendations. At present, the draft legislation clauses do not do that. And at this point, I'm looking at Ian Gray, who uses the quotes from John P. McIntosh and having in the past, and I'll use this one, I think, because we don't have the position we want now, that doesn't mean to say we can't achieve that position as a Parliament. And he said in a speech on the Scotland Bill before the House of Commons in 1976, institutions have to be the servants of political demands. We have people in Scotland who want a degree of government for themselves at the Scottish level. It's not beyond the wit of man to devise the institutions to meet those demands and thus strengthen the unity of the United Kingdom. I want to briefly highlight in closing this debate on behalf of the Devolution and Further Powers Committee the headline areas where current draft clauses fall short. On welfare, as we've heard, the current clauses do not deliver Smith, but also that the significant challenges will exist in implementing the proposed powers. On income tax, the significant implementation issues remain to be resolved, such as the definition of a Scottish taxpayer, how to avoid double taxation, and the timing of phasing of new powers in relation to those arriving under the Scotland Act 2012. On the fiscal framework, that the detail of this framework should be available for scrutiny by this Parliament before the issue of legislative consent for any new bill is considered. And then on the Crown Estate, the committee has serious concerns regarding the potential for completion, competition and confusion that may arise from the creation of two Crown estates. No one wants to rule out the chance for inward investment, as Lewis MacDonald alluded to, but the committee were clear that there must be scope for shared investments between the two Crown estates, with a fair share of revenues accruing to Scotland. On the permanency of the Scottish Parliament, that the Scottish electorate be asked to vote on the referendum should the issue of permanency come into question, as well as majorities being required in the Scottish and UK Parliaments. As Bruce Crawford highlighted in the opening debate, the issue of intergovernmental relations has permeated every aspect of the committee's scrutiny of the proposals for further devolution. There is no question that the shift from a devolved settlement based on a system largely separate powers to one of shared powers cannot be borne by the current non-statutory ad hoc nature of intergovernmental relations currently at work in the UK. Again, issues that were taken in the interest of Tavish Scott and indeed Linda Fabiani and Elaine Murray pointed out some of those complexities today. In particular, the committee is clear in saying that the need for a revised intergovernmental structures will be most critical in the areas of taxation, welfare, employment, support and European Union representation. The structures that emerge will be required to deal with the uneven distribution of powers across the constituent parts of the UK. The committee is also clear in stating that the general principles underpinning the operation of intergovernmental relations should be placed in statute. Presiding officer, the role of Parliament in scrutinising the operation of intergovernmental relations in this new landscape of devolution will be a key challenge to which this institution must respond. The Devolution Committee intends to consider these issues in the coming months. I know, Presiding Officer, that this is an area that you are looking into along with the Speaker of the House of Commons. We will play our full part as a committee in supporting you to ensure committees in both parliaments hold their governments to account. This will involve learning from practice of parliamentary scrutiny and other jurisdictions and seeking to develop a set of principles that which this could structure parliamentary scrutiny in this area. We have set a high bar today in terms of the common approach of the committee, I speak on behalf of the committee at this point by saying we will continue that high standard in the future. We'll seek to get reports to this Parliament that achieve the level of agreement that we have at this time. That will be your challenge in the coming months. I don't say that that will be easy, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Mr McNeill. I've already privately congratulated the convener on the report, but can I take this opportunity to thank all the members of the Devolution Further Powers Committee. You have done the Parliament a great service. Can I now move on to decision time? There is one question to be put as a result of today's business. The question is that motion number 13160, in the name of Bruce Crawford on New Powers for Scotland, an interim report on the Smith Commission and the UK Government's proposals be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
The motion is therefore agreed to. That concludes decision time, and I now close this meeting.